Life goes easy on me tonight. It's been a while since I last told you.
WZR Army! It is Thursday, July 3rd, 2014. Time for another edition of WZR TV Thursdays. TV Thursdays.
Still got the T.
Still got the T?
Yes.
It's been a couple of weeks, my man. Oh, that's right. Yikes. We don't want that to happen. Get out of here with that. But it's been a couple of weeks since we have seen you guys.
I don't know why you look at me. You see me every day. Those guys don't. Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, I see you every day. But it's been a while since we've seen you guys. You know, listen. 2 weeks ago on Tuesday, to be honest with you, I was having a rough day. It wasn't a good day. The week wasn't going good. It was very busy, dealing with some personal issues, and then I get a knock on the door. And anybody that lives in the Northeast, you know how bad this winter was. It was freezing cold. There was a lot of snow.
It was bad.
So we would get these electric bills. And mind you, we live in an apartment that has a couple of bedrooms. And only one of us was using the heat. I mean, pretty much. I mean, we would turn ours on every morning,
and that was it.
But, so I'm getting these electric bills from National Grid for, you know, $540. $610, $580, right?
New electric, not to interject your story. Good call cutting off the air conditioner. I'm sweating my nuts off.
It's beautiful in here right now. So, we're getting these electric bills for like $500, $600 every month. And I'm thinking, what is going on? And then they're doing all these news stories where everybody...
Yeah, mainstream story, or local story mainstream.
Everybody's saying the same thing. We're getting electric bills for $400 or $500. People that own homes up in the Northeast, we're getting, you know, $600 bills every month. Well, I can't afford that. You know what I mean? I mean, $600 a month for electric. That doesn't include rent. That doesn't include Time Warner and cable and internet and telephones and cell phones and all that
cars.
Other stuff. So, you know, basically, and then it became a big headline on the news because, like you said, everybody was dealing with the same thing and nobody could afford their bills. So, they had said that, you know, we'll give you a couple of months to pay it off. And I'd been paying it off, giving them $200-$300 every now and then, right? The lady shows up at the door and she says, you've got a National Grid bill for $810, which isn't that bad compared to some people. I know the people that Allison babysits for, they've got a bill down there for $1,800 after the winter. $1,800.
That's 1 month?
That's throughout the winter, but $1,800 has added up because they can't afford to pay as much as National Grid was charging. So they're looking into National Grid right now. There's a big, you know, the whole state's looking in, and nobody can seem to figure out why the rates have gone up, because you guys got to understand that in the summer months, even when we use the air conditioning, I'm getting bills here for $130, $140 a month. You're talking $500, $600. That's 4 or 5 times the amount.
It's a lot of
gravy. You guys know what I'm talking about. Anybody that uses National Grid knows what I'm talking about. Where it was ridiculous over the winter months. So comes down to, a lady shows up at my door. I'm having a rough day last Tuesday, and a lady shows up at my door, and she says, "You need to write us a check right now for
$7." She wasn't mean about it.
No, she was. To her credit, she was extremely nice.
She seemed empathetic, like, or sympathetic, what's the word I'm looking for?
But how many...
She had empathy or sympathy for us, where she was like, I hate to have to do this, you know, I hate doing this part.
How many people, I mean, she's got it down to a science, because she's probably got to go to 40, 50 people's houses per day. She's got it down to a science.
All of her interaction with other human beings on a daily basis is uncomfortable.
Or with pissed off people.
Yes, it's all uncomfortable interactions. Every interaction is like, I'm sorry, it's my job. And they're like, but I got a baby. And you feel like a shithead.
Right.
But it's your job. What are you going to do, you know?
So I had to write her a check for $710, and this happened at like 3, 4 o'clock in the afternoon or something like that. I had to write her a check for $710, and that just pissed me off, man. I was not in a good mood, so I figured, you know what, we'll cancel WZR and we'll do it on Wednesday or Thursday. If you've been on the website for the last 2 or 3 weeks, it has been unbelievable news-wise. I mean, with the budget cuts, with the releases, which we haven't even talked about.
We haven't talked about a lot of stuff. Like releases. I said, the last time we were on the air, the bank hadn't happened yet.
Right, right.
So we're way behind.
So turned out that last, you know, we were going to do a show Wednesday or Thursday night. Last Wednesday and Thursday and Friday, TNA was doing their TV tapings in New York City. So it just got ridiculous.
Well, that and Derek got injured, which ended up being him getting stripped of the IC title.
So much.
Like, there was so just much. A different story every day. Something, you know, the Emma thing came out, Josh Matthews thing came out.
So then,
a lot of stuff.
Then we're ready to go. Everything is good to go this past Tuesday. 2 days ago. We get to this week. Everything's good to go.
Yeah, that's right. I thought it was yesterday. Yeah, 2 days ago.
I go on the websites. I put up the live chat room post. You're in the shower. You're taking a shower.
Yep.
I put up the live chat room post. I'm getting ready to do the live post. Boom comes out of the bathroom, goes into his room. He says, dude, comes in, and he's got this worried look on his face. And he says, dude, I don't know what's going on with my computer, dude. It's lagging. You got to check this out. You were in the shower. So whatever happened, some sort of malware.
Totally random, yeah.
Some sort of malware installed on your computer. So I'm sitting in the
What I do is I have a ritual every Tuesday night because we've had problems in the past where the audio would be behind the video.
Right.
And that's usually when my computer gets skipping. It's
laggy, right.
Which what we produce the show off of, which we're producing it off of right now.
Right.
And in the past, there's been times where the audio's been behind the video. And ever since then, I've made it a point, because usually it's a web browser-related issue, something on the internet.
Right.
So I make it a point every week to restart my computer on Tuesday morning. You know, I do my work and stuff, but an hour before the show, I close out the browser.
Mm-hmm.
I go to, you know, the task manager, and make sure there's nothing running that shouldn't be, and then I just leave it alone for that last hour.
So then I know that everything's gonna be good.
Because I have to have Winamp open anyway for our playlist, our theme song, the rest of the themes that we play, the commercial music, all that stuff.
Right.
I loaded up Winamp, you know, like I always do to take a shower, because, you know, I shave and shower. I didn't shave this week, but
I didn't either.
Yeah, I'm lazy. I didn't much feel like doing a show this week.
I didn't need
on a Thursday. I was ready Tuesday.
Do you remember what I said to these people on Tuesday night?
The bet you made, or the
that's why we're doing a show, dude.
All right, we'll get to that. But normally I play Winamp. You know, when I take a shower, I play music.
Right.
So I had my music playing. Nothing else was on. Nothing else was loaded up. Browser was closed. My normal ritual. I get out of the shower and my music is skipping.
Right.
Like crazy. And I'm in the shower, and I locked my door. I forget why. Somebody had put something in here and asked me, you know, so I locked the door so that nobody could get in. I've got the bathroom door locked. I've got the master bedroom, so I've got a direct door to the bathroom, and then there's a door to the bathroom in the hallway. So that's the bathroom door I lock when I'm in the bathroom. You can't get to my door to the bathroom because my front door is locked. So there's no way to get in this
moral
room.
Moral of the story is nobody can get in.
Yeah, nobody can get in this room, nobody can get in the bathroom. There's no way nobody touched my computer. And when I come out, it's skipping and chopping and lagging, and from there I go to tell him, and he takes over, and that ultimately turned out to be why we didn't do a show.
Well, I tried to work on it. I tried to work on it frantically, dude, for that half an hour that we had from about 7:30 to 8 o'clock. I couldn't get the thing to work, so finally I said to you,
it was so slow, you couldn't do anything to even try.
Right. It was, the mouse was lagging.
Everything.
Boom doesn't have the patience for that.
No.
He gets frustrated. So I sat down, I tried my hardest. So I said to Boone, I said, go in there and put the audio stream up and tell these people that we were ready to do a show on Tuesday night. So we came on, we gave you a little bit of audio on Tuesday, and then it turns out that,
very little.
You know, I've got the format discs and everything else to format your computer. I was ready to format the computer, but I said, you know what? Even though your computer is lagging like crazy, I'm going to try to take malware bytes, or bits, a scanner, and try to scan the computer. Well, I started scanning the computer, and I get about halfway through the scan, and it was just tick-tock. It would have taken all night, probably half of the next day.
Well, the whole thing took, 3 hours, I think you said, when you were
done? So I wound up stopping the scan. I said, fuck this. And when I stopped the scan, it had found 14 different viruses that were on there. It still allowed me, despite stopping the scan, it still allowed me to delete
So
even though you stopped mid-scan, you were still, and you were going to move on and just go ahead and format it. And you're like, well, before I do that, let me go ahead and just, there's 14 viruses here, let me just go ahead and quarantine those.
Right, so you
and then I'll format it.
So you quarantine them, and I go through one by one, and of course the mouse is lagging, and 20 minutes later, after I get them all quarantined, the computer's blazing fast again. So whatever it found, one of those 14 things, and then we did another virus scan, Jesus. We did another virus. I said to Boone, I said, before you go to bed tonight, I want you to do one more virus scan.
They're talking about the video is slow right now.
Oh, it's always a little bit laggy.
Okay, let's hope that's it.
But, so I said to you, before you go to bed tonight,
yes,
I want you to do a virus
scan. And I asked you to remind me, and you never did.
I didn't.
You're right. I still did.
You're right. Yeah. But, so anyways, I got really drunk on Tuesday night.
So did I.
That
passed
pissed
out.
Me off.
I passed out in my chair. Yeah, me too.
I was pissed.
You were
so drunk.
Wasn't just a show for me. If we didn't get that fixed, I would have no way to work. I would have no way to watch Howard Stern or watch TV or movies or anything I do on it.
Oh, your porn would have been gone if we formatted?
Obviously, if I have a computer, I've got porn, that would have been gone.
Absolutely.
Literally, my whole life is my computer.
So I said to you, make sure before you go to bed on Tuesday night, run a virus scan, and then when you wake up on Wednesday morning, yesterday morning, I will help you and we'll quarantine. All you had to do was quarantine.
Yeah.
But anyways, we wake up. Boone runs a virus checker. Would you have like a 114?
Some crazy
like that?
Amount, yeah.
Some crazy
it wasn't
number.
It was infected files.
There were cookies and things.
A lot
like
of stuff
that.
Was nothing. Right. Yeah, most of them were nothing. But there were a couple of big ones that they called.
He had all this stuff in the registry. That's what I dealt with on Tuesday night. But
so
anyway,
there was a lot of old cache files, like text files. And
so it's running good, right? Everything's
since
good.
Since then, knock on wood, it's been fine.
Everything's good to go. So
I mean,
we
it's
didn't
still
have
a
to
piece
format.
Of shit, but it's back to being its normal piece of shit self.
We didn't have to format. You got your porn, and
porn.
You got all your
got
Stern and
all my Howard Stern. I
you're
still
good
got
to
everything.
Go.
Yeah.
So we're fixed. And then yesterday it got so busy. We were gonna do show yesterday, and it got so busy. And then we said, no, you know what? Because I made that bet.
Well, Wednesday's always been a busy day. Yeah.
Right. If you didn't hear the audio on Tuesday night, I said, listen, if we don't do a show this week, I will come on here next Tuesday night, and I will do a show without my hat. And if you've been following me for years and years and years now, this hat doesn't come off. So there was no way that we weren't doing a show either last night or tonight, and we're doing it right now.
It made me feel better about my computer, because at first I'm like, well, look. Because
I
don't
know,
how to
know it's
it.
Going to get fixed.
Yeah, I don't know how to fix it. I'm relying on him to fix it. And I'm like, well, after WZR tonight, he don't give a fuck if my computer works. And what does he give a shit? But then when he put his hat on the line, I'm like, oh, well, I'm going to have my computer fixed then. Because
it was a busy Tuesday night,
I
too.
Know.
And the nice guy that I am said, you know what, work can hold off. I got to fix Boone's computer.
Well, let's not get to it. You had me do a couple things for you for work-wise while you were...
You typed some things
I did
for
a couple
me.
Things for
appreciate
you.
Appreciate it.
No problem.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Anyways, so here we are. That's the reason we weren't here the week before, and then this week as well. But we're still here this week. So anyways, we have a lot to talk about, man. It's every day it seems like something big has been breaking. You talked about it earlier. Wade Barrett's shoulder surgery.
Yeah.
Daniel Bryan. Looks like Daniel Bryan may need a second surgery on his neck. If that's the case, he's going to be out damn near a year.
At least.
The Emma situation from yesterday we got to talk about.
Josh Matthews.
All the releases.
All the
firings.
All the returns on Monday.
The four returns on
Monday
night.
I had three. What's the fourth?
I got four. I got AJ Lee. I got Chris Jericho. I've got The Miz. And I've got...
I got those three. It was the fourth.
I've got... who was the other one? There was one more. There was one more. Can't remember.
No fourth.
I'll think it'll come to me.
No fourth.
And there was a fourth.
Ask the chat.
There was a fourth name.
On
all? AJ Lee.
You already said AJ.
I did.
Re-Sam.
I said Chris Jericho.
Mm-hmm. You're going to get stuck.
The Miz.
Yeah. AJ and who else?
AJ Lee and, I just named him, didn't I?
No, you said AJ Toys.
There's
I got three.
Guy.
I got three names returning. I didn't have four.
I don't know.
Vince didn't return. That was Sandow.
No, that was Sandow.
Yeah. But that teaser got you at first. The
it did get me.
I was popping. You hear me in here popping?
It did get me. Yeah.
I was going nuts when I heard that. And
Kali! The great Kali!
Ah, shit, you're right.
Boom!
See, that shouldn't count.
Who got it in the chat? Jericho-holic in the chat.
Who even knew he was gone? That shouldn't even count.
He's been going for a while. He's been working house shows and things like that. But,
he didn't do anything.
So anyway, four returns.
You got me. You were right. I was wrong.
Anyways, all right, so we're going to, this is what we're going to do. We're not going to go through Money in the Bank and Raw as a whole. Money in the Bank,
Money in the Bank, we should say, is A.
We're going to talk about that.
You said Money in the Bank was shit?
No, it was a great show.
It was amazing.
I was going to say shit, it was 2 weeks ago.
The other two things, Seth Rollins is Mr. Money in the Bank.
Right.
John Cena's new WWE World Heavyweight Champion.
Right.
That's
right.
The two news items.
Got SummerSlam, big plans for SummerSlam. We got the WWE Network. They are worried beyond belief, man.
Well, we get to find that number out fairly soon, about a month from now, right?
What number?
The network number. They're going to do it at every conference call, every quarterly.
Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're supposed to reveal the official subscription count every quarterly conference call.
Okay. Well, the next one, no, the one in the fall is going to be the one where it's interesting, because the six-month subscriptions are going to be...
No, the one coming up now, the one in August, or no, wait, when is
we're
when
in
is
September.
The call? Because it would be right around August that it would expire.
They may be okay.
You're right, it's probably not the one until the fall.
You're right, it's not going to be
which
the one
is like
until
4 months
later,
after we find out.
Right,
they subscribe either at the end of August or beginning of September. They either they resubscribe or they don't.
Exactly.
The six we're talking about the guys who, which is most of them, that have 6 month subscriptions because you have to buy 6 months.
You've got
to
get the six right.
That signed up the day it launched or for WrestleMania. Well, not WrestleMania weekend, but the day it launched and all that stuff, right? Or are we
right around the same time? It was the day it launched in WrestleMania. It's about a month difference.
It launched in January. I mean, it was at the end of January.
Was it January?
It was like January 30th or something.
Was it?
Right? Ask the chat. It was. I think it was the end of January, or it was very early February. I'm pretty sure.
Well, it's within a 1 or 2 month period there.
Yeah.
That.
But the first round of subscriptions is up, which means the not WrestleMania people, the launch people. And that's a significant thing, because I'm sure a lot of people signed up for WrestleMania, and that's when their 6 months begin.
Right. Well, we'll see what happens. And then, did they sign up again for next year's WrestleMania? Did they take a break?
Well, that's what I'm saying. We find out, at least the people that signed up the day it launched, and any time before WrestleMania, pretty much, we'll find out of those people that subscribed who resubscribed.
Can we say this, that the WWE Network, I don't want to say... It hasn't been a complete failure.
Oh, okay, February 16th.
Yeah,
when
it was
launched.
In February, right.
The announcement was in January at that international CES.
Right, where they did the... The
announcement, yeah.
The network hasn't been a complete fail, but it's been a fail.
It's financially, it's a huge failure.
It's a huge failure.
But that's because of things they did to themselves. They
well, in the overseas, too.
Well, it's just a matter of that they put more money in than they should have.
Yeah.
And they charged less than they should have for the service. And WrestleMania
Absolutely.
Is a question mark. Because if you would have left WrestleMania outside of the network, I'm saying you still get a lot of those subscriptions that you got in the first place.
You couldn't do that? You couldn't do that because the cable companies... Well, not at that time. At that time, they were still airing WrestleMania. But the cable companies are now, almost all of them, are no longer carrying WWE pay-per-view.
But I'm saying as far as the network being a failure or success, let's put it this way, hypothetical scenario. Let's say, do we take calls now or no?
No.
Yeah, we got a lot to get to. We're taking calls now or two. Hang in there, guys. But let's say that they decided to charge $15 instead of $10 for the service. Let's say they kept WrestleMania off the first year, saw what the numbers looked like, and then if they needed it, the next year be like, and you get WrestleMania.
Right.
As opposed to straight out of the gate, $10 and WrestleMania and all, you know. But now where do you go? What more can you offer? There's nothing left to offer.
But what I'm saying...
You would have did that first year without WrestleMania, you could have said, well, now we offer this, which is huge,
wait
WrestleMania,
a minute.
Or the price.
But wait, okay, that would work out. That would work out fine, but if you're going to say, okay, for this year you've got to order WrestleMania through the cable companies, the following year we're going to offer it to you for free. The cable companies weren't going to be offering WrestleMania next year.
No, they might have. The cable companies really care about WrestleMania. Now, if they would have given WrestleMania exclusive to the cable companies, I'm not even sure if they'd give a shit about Backlash, No Way Out, and all that crap. So they might
sure
not.
Sure, they do. They make some money, but anyways.
They would have done business with WWE if they said, "Yo, we give WrestleMania just to you."
That's true.
They would have done business with them for that.
Right.
So then, what you do is you charge $15 a month for all pay-per-views except WrestleMania, and that's how you come out of the gate with this network. Now, the $15 a month figure before you think about WrestleMania, because now that's everybody's expectation because that's what they did.
Right.
But let's say they didn't do that. $15 a month for every pay-per-view, which essentially would be what they do one a month. Let's take one away for WrestleMania. 11 pay-per-views. At $30, $45 a pop, whatever it is, for $15 a month. So you're getting them less than half price as it is. So you're going to get the people who buy those, so you're getting 200, 300,000, not 600,000, but at $15 a pop. And then, let's say on top of the $200,000 to $300,000 base of people that would buy the network without WrestleMania, let's say that other content, Countdown, Legends House, NXT, all that stuff that in the archives and all that stuff, let's say that's another 150,000, 200,000. There you got 450,000, 500,000. Then the next year, if you offer WrestleMania, you can get it up to 600. So you're at the same number, but all along you're charging $15 instead of $10.
Absolutely. $5, I couldn't agree
more. $5 more per prescription, for subscription.
They're still getting a smoking deal. Yeah. They're still getting a smoking deal. If you did, listen, it makes more sense to start the network, what is it, $9.99 or something like that for 6 months.
You start at 15,
if you start at 15, and then you say, well, we can lower the price a little bit.
Yes.
But if you start at $9.99, and now you've got to raise the price, it's going to make you look
worse. You have to raise
the
price if you don't hit at your estimations, which they set high.
Right.
Based on a dumb survey, they said there's one wrestling fan out of every household, or every two households, whatever the fuck it was. There's like 80 million wrestling fans.
For $9.99, I couldn't agree more. They should have started that network at $14.99 or $15, something like
without
that.
Without WrestleMania.
With it, even
because
without,
no, without WrestleMania, because that one pay-per-view alone, a million buys, and if you get it all through the pay-per-view company, that is an additional how many millions of dollars?
A lot of millions.
That
you add
to what you make from the network, that you add to what you get in television rights fees increases because the deal was up.
Right.
It would have been a whole different year if they had put it that way.
It just, they, listen, $15 a month and WWE fans are still getting a smoking deal because you're getting
now
a
pay-per-view. Now it sounds like shit.
You're getting a $40 pay-per-view, $50, $60 if you order in high definition.
Exactly.
You're getting that for $15. In addition to that, we're not just talking pay-per-views. We're talking all the content on the network. So $15, that is a steal.
And like I said, that sounds
anybody.
Bad now because it's $10. So you're saying, damn, you're jacking it up 33%.
$5, but if they had started
there. If you started with that.
Right
out of the gate, people would have said, damn, that's a pretty fucking good deal.
Right.
With WrestleMania at $10, it's a holy shit, that's a perfect deal.
I know.
But obviously, that's putting all your eggs in one basket right out of the gate, and if that doesn't work,
you've got to raise the price
to make
up.
You've got nowhere to go. You can't add something to it, because WrestleMania and everything else is already with it. The only thing you can do is jack the price up.
And that's, people are going to see that, and they're going to say, well, why are you jacking the price?
That, and you're not going to get a big inswell of new subscribers.
Well, why are you jacking the price, and you're not adding all that much
new why are you adding the price? Like, all right, you're charging $5 more because of what? Just because you need it? Like,
because
you're not
you
giving
it?
Us nothing more for it?
And with the budget cuts,
yeah.
Do you think they're going to be adding a lot of new content? I don't think so.
Well, those budget cuts didn't make up for a fraction of what they're losing. I mean, they're going to be losing, what, $50 million they projected this year?
I think so, but Vince,
you
we
just
put it
slashed
up.
Maybe, what, $2 million at best in budget
about
cuts?
About that.
Or not in budget cuts, because they've changed a lot of production things, too.
Right.
But in roster cuts.
Right.
$2 million is a fucking drop in the bucket of $50 million.
We put up on the website yesterday that recently, within the last couple of weeks, Vince McMahon ordered in the tens of millions of dollars as far as budget cuts. I mean, you're talking 10,
he
20,
wants to
30.
Offset. It's $50 million,
million,
which is tens of millions. It's five tens of millions. $50 million is the losses they're expected with the upstart of the network.
Mm-hmm.
So they want to offset as much as possible. So they want to get as close to fucking cutting $50 million of their budget as they can. Obviously, they're not going to get there. But their goal is to, slash anything we don't need or curb stuff we do use that we don't need to do this much with.
How many talents did they fire last week? 11? Was
11,
that the number?
And then you got Matthews added to it, so 12.
Let's figure that. Let's just take 11 or 12 talents that they cut, right?
Yeah.
And you're trying to slash $50 million. I guarantee you, out of the 11 talents they cut, what are they saving? Maybe $2 million? Out of all of them.
Let's say baseline average, they make $250,000 a year.
I was gonna say $150,000, $200,000.
Let's say $250,000.
They're mid-carders, so
just
I don't know.
Just highball it.
All right.
So at best,
is that how many zeros is that? One, two.
Three. That's it. $250,000.
Oh, right there. Oh, you're.
$250,000 and times that by 11.
11 times.
Or 12.
Oh shit.
Because Matthews.
12. Times 250, 1, 2, 3.
You're saving what?
Was that 3 mil?
Yeah.
3 mil.
3 million.
Yeah.
You're saving $3 million And then you're looking to cut $50 million in cost.
Yeah.
And it's not close to $3 million. I think it's more around like maybe 2.2, 2.3.
Yeah, it's not even $3 million.
Those were mid-card people, man. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They're not getting paid $250,000 a year. Josh Matthews is not getting paid $250,000 a year. A guy like... Bullis Clay and people like that, they're not getting paid $250,000.
As I said, highball is at best. Yeah, right. But like I said, you're losing about $1 million or $2 million in budget, or in roster cuts.
It helps a little bit, because you've got about $48 million to go, or $49 million to
cut
go.
A couple, I don't want to say a couple million, because that's just guessing, but they've cut a lot of money on, like, they cut out the SmackDown pre and post shows.
Right.
They reduced budget costs for the pre shows.
Let me ask you about that.
Kickoff shows.
With the Raw pre show.
They stopped bringing around the Exotic Express bus and the Fandango's entrance. And
so they were,
I mean, they're cutting stuff wherever they can.
They're cutting stuff, no doubt. But, all right, you've got the Raw pre show, right? Which they're now taping from Stamford, Connecticut, right?
Studio, yeah.
Right from WWE Studios in Stamford, right out of the WWE headquarters.
The offices. Yeah.
They still need to fly in Booker T all the way from Texas. That's going to cost them money to bring Booker T up to Stamford every week. I mean, it's going to add up after a while. $400 plane ticket each time.
And
stuff
you're getting
like that adds up.
Now.
No,
I mean,
he's
on the road anyway, so, I mean, part-time for
part-time,
stuff like that.
But to fly him in, that's what I'm worried.
That's a cost they're already doing. That's not a new cost.
Well, if they're cutting, I mean,
going to the studio more than offsets flying Booker T to Stamford.
If they're flying Booker T to Raw or SmackDown to do the pre-show, or they're flying Booker T to Stamford, Connecticut to do the pre-show, it's pretty much the same amount of money.
So there's no losses or gains in that equation as far as flying people into the studio or into the live arena.
Well, if you're going to do that, why move the pre-show?
Because moving it to the studio, you've got all your stuff there. You don't have to pay trucks to travel with equipment. You don't have to pay satellite, whatever the fuck, the production stuff that I'm not privy to. I'm not a production expert. But
for the pre-show stuff,
it's the same
that
as taking
do.
A show live versus taped. It's the same.
Yeah, but
reducing those costs.
It's not like the pre-show has pyro and all this stuff. The pre-show has one announce desk and a camera.
But it's
that's
the fact
about
that
it.
They're shooting it live. Is whatever it takes to do live to live a
Maybe
live
that's
shoot
what it is,
a
right.
truck for a satellite to do the live stream.
Oh, right. You're right.
A truck for the cords and the whatever the fuck. That's what I said. I don't know the technical aspect
right,
of production.
Right. You're right.
But the equation would be like a live SmackDown versus a tape SmackDown.
Right.
How much do they really save cutting that, you know, from live to tape? It's whatever it costs to make a show live. I don't know.
Right. And
hopefully it's a lot.
I don't. Well, it may be a lot, but it's little things that they're cutting. I mean, they're cutting.
Unnecessary shit, yeah.
You know,
it's not necessary to be
stuff.
There live if it'll save you money.
Like for the WWE, you know, production guys, some of the guys that set up the ring and, you know, the truck drivers and things like that, they are no longer providing the 18-wheeler buses that they had.
Or you could just set the ring up quicker and cut your fucking thumb off like Charles Robinson did.
Yeah,
remember that
I
picture?
Know, I know.
Woo-hoo.
You know?
That'll teach you to fucking rush your job.
They are cutting costs like crazy, which we'll get into a little bit more as we move on here. All right, let's get these plugs out of the way, and then we're going to touch base on Money in the Bank. We'll just do the real high points and the real low points. We'll touch base on Monday Night Raw, talk about the returns from Monday's Raw, and then all the news and rumors. We want to talk to you guys about the WWE releases. Who were you guys surprised to see go? The TNA New York City series, which were said to have been
Down for Glory in Japan.
Down for Glory in
Six-sided
Japan.
Six-sided ring returning.
Speaking of cost-cutting, we put an article up on the website today. TNA Bound for Glory is probably going to air on tape delay as if it were to air live in the United States. Those guys would have to be in Japan at 7 a.m. in the morning when
that?
We watch it live.
Yeah,
it's 12,
true.
It's about a 12-hour difference.
Yeah.
So they would have to... They would have to...
The six-sided ring's coming back.
Right.
The TNA TV title is inactive as of today.
As of today, right.
Just like the IC title in WWE. Are they copying WWE again? No, I'm just kidding. But
wait a minute. Do you know that we just put an article up on the website, and we're going to have more details. Jeff Jarrett is going to be launching his Global Force Wrestling promotion here in probably, you know, maybe early 2015. It's still months away, but... Jarrett had planned, according to people close to him, had planned to try to make his promotion stand out a little bit, and there was talk that the GFW promotion was going to use the six-sided ring, as
really?
Jeff Jarrett was the original person,
founded
the guy.
That concept.
He founded the concept of the six-sided rings. There was talk that Jarrett may use that for his Global Force Wrestling promotion, and now there are people in TNA kind of, I guess, rolling their eyes a little bit, you know, where they got wind that Jeff Jarrett maybe bring in the six-sided ring to set himself apart from other promotions.
They beat him to
TNA,
the punch.
They beat him to the punch, and it's kind of a cheap shot to say, fuck
you, Jarrett. A lot of the talent didn't seem to enjoy that
they don't
fact.
Like it.
Yeah, they're tweeting about, like, hey, nice that the fans get to decide what we fucking slam our bodies on and run into every day, you know.
Do you know that we put it up on the website, I believe at some point last week, where, like Boone said, the guys are pissed off. Austin
Top
Aries,
guys, Magnus, Austin Aries, fucking.
They found out, the TNA talents found out that the six-sided ring would be returning when that poll went up on ImpactWrestling.com.
Yeah.
There was no backstage meeting. Yeah. There was no, hey, we're thinking about bringing. Nobody had any idea, and then they saw a poll go up on ImpactWrestling.com. And let's be honest. We all saw the poll go up, and there were four-sided ring or six-sided ring.
Yes.
What do you think everybody's going to vote for? Of course they're going to vote for the six-sided
ring.
Give me a rest.
The poll's on the internet.
On ImpactWrestling.com.
But on the internet, where you're polling the internet audience, of course the internet audience is going to want the six-sided ring.
Of course. So
maybe the casual audience would be like, no, I just want wrestling.
Right. But as soon as that poll went up on ImpactWrestling.com, the TNA talent said, whoa. We haven't heard anything about this, and we know, you guys know, we know what the results of this poll are going to be, and nobody told us ahead of time.
Yeah, you didn't ask if, like, we're cool with it. Or,
right. Yeah. You would think that the guys that have to work in the ring, you would hold some sort of backstage meeting and say, hey, like Boone said, you guys cool with this if we bring it back?
And
if there was a lot of negativity
then,
towards
maybe
it,
you don't
then
do it.
Maybe you don't do
Who
it.
Who cares if GFW is a six-sided ring? How fucking much of a difference does that really
make? You should ask the people that have to work in that ring before going public on the internet.
It was AJ Styles, I think, that was on Austin's podcast recently. I was trying to think of somebody, I think it was AJ Styles on Austin's podcast. That was talking about the difference between the four-sided and the six-sided ring. And I forget what he said, but he basically broke it down to where it's like, yeah, that motherfucker is worse on the wrestlers. You know, it might look cool on TV, but honestly, how cool does it look?
It's a lot stiffer, I guess.
I think it's harder to land on. I think the distance is shorter to run, so it throws your timing off. It makes matches. You know, if you're not a good worker, you have to, you know, really be able to adapt. And,
right.
It's just, it's complicating things for the sake of complicating things.
Right.
What benefit is there to a six? Oh, it looks cooler?
Right.
Does that give you better ratings? Sell more tickets, more merchandise.
Speaking
what's the point?
Speaking of stiffer rings and working stiffer, I mean, put the article up on the website today with WWE. You see all these guys getting, you know, potato shots, eye pokes as well, concussions, separated shoulders, all sorts of things. WWE's told their employees with the high definition cameras that they've got these days. Yeah. Trying to make it look more realistic, so they're telling their talents, hey. Oh,
I got you. Come here.
Okay. Yeah. That hurts. That hurts.
Those are punches in the face right there.
That kind of hurt. But anyways, it's to the point where you would do stuff like that in a WWE, where I felt that. I felt that, but it didn't knock me out.
No.
But when
they want you to lay him in full power, full speed, and
when you're going faster,
just miss or
right.
I hit my hand like I just did, just beat the fuck out of my hand.
Well, that hurt a little bit, but it's to the point where it didn't knock me out.
No,
still
you were able to continue your sentence as if nothing happened. So it obviously wasn't painful, but the chances of me slipping and accidentally hitting your eye with a knuckle.
Yes.
Or slipping through and hitting your head.
Much
greater
when you're doing that. And that's why you've seen John Cena got the black eye.
John Cena, well, Roman Reigns and Orton were a collision of heads. But they asked the guys to step up the intensity as well, I heard. Which is why you're getting thrown into a barricade and separating your shoulder. Which is why Orton and Reigns are colliding the heads. Which is why, you know, all these things, concussions are happening.
Because you're working a faster-paced style to make it more, make it
to
look.
To tell that crew, that the current WWE crew, what they don't get enough credit for as a crew, you know, that it might seem like it's more PG these days, and that. The work rate in the ring is about as good as it's ever been.
I agree
Up
with
and down
that.
The card. I mean, you got guys that are fast-paced. There is no phoning it in. There's no Hulk Hogan, I'm going to big boot you, leg drop you, one, two, three.
Right.
No, these guys have an arsenal of offensive thing, you know, they do, and a lot of it's high impact, a lot of it's fast paced, a lot of it's high risk, and it's going to bang you up over time, especially if you ask them, hey, pick it up a step, you know what I mean?
Right,
how much fucking harder and faster can they go?
And that's why you're
the
seeing...
The jokes right there that you could... How much harder and faster can they go?
Oh, jeez.
All the jokes.
What do you want? Make a sexual joke or something?
If we had, like, a sound bite, I'd hit, like, the Beavis and Butthead laugh right there.
All right, so let's get the plugs out of the way. Like I said, we're going to touch base on Money in the Bank. Run down Monday Night Raw. It's just high points, low points. Then we'll
Raw was a busy fucking show on Monday.
Raw was a busy show. Money in the Bank was a very good show.
Good show, but not like oh god, how much do we have to talk about? Unless you talk about how great every match was. Raw, there was like so many things to talk about.
A lot of stuff went down on Raw, man. And then we've got a lot of backstage news. Talked about the releases and everything else.
Your phone calls, all that stuff.
Phone calls, all that good stuff. By the way, the pool opened today.
Did it today?
It's today. It opened today, so we've got it for the weekend, man.
I have to have a pool party for my birthday, which is 6 days away.
Coming up, July 9th.
6 days away.
July 9th. This man's got a birthday.
I hit the big 3-0.
Is that next Tuesday?
It's next Wednesday.
Wednesday. Yes. So next Tuesday, we're going to have a birthday celebration for you.
Wonderful. Wasn't your birthday on Tuesday?
Yeah, damn right I did WZR-TV. Yeah,
I was here.
So we're gonna have a birthday celebration for Matty Boone next week.
God, I don't know about
next
all that.
Tuesday night, birthday. So we're gonna be here anyway. So you don't think we're not gonna celebrate?
Tuesday. It's July 8th. My birthday's July 9th.
We're gonna drink a lot of beers the night before your birthday.
Do that anyway.
On your birthday, you get tanked. Well, we're gonna do it extra next Tuesday night. So anyways, the official website, the official home of WZR-TV Tuesdays, WZRonline.com. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube as well. Go to Facebook.com/WZRArmy, YouTube.com/WZRArchive, and we're on Twitter as well. Just go to WZRonline.com, top navigation bar, social media tab, drop-down menu. It's got all the links to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. WZRonline.com, the official home of WZR-TV Tuesdays. Every Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern Time, WZRonline.com.
Except for this one.
Boo!
We're on Thursday.
We're on Thursday this week.
Yes.
By the way, happy 4th of July to everybody out there, to our American viewers tomorrow. We're doing a barbecue.
We're doing the
hamburgers, the hot dogs, and the buns, and all that stuff. Clean off the grill out back. Maybe go take a dip in the pool.
Sounds like a good day. Drink some beers.
Friday, July 4th, 2014. So hopefully you guys be safe, man. Don't drink and drive. Don't be out there drinking. I know everybody drinks and drives and gets drunk over 4th of July weekend.
Don't
you know what I mean?
Kids.
Be safe out there. We want to see you guys next Tuesday night. We want to see you here. Live chat room on and in progress.
Where?
Lots of people in there on a Thursday night. WZRonline.com.
.com/chat.
WZRonline.com/chat. Get in there. Lots and lots of people here on a Thursday night. All right, brother. Money in the Bank from this past
week. MITB.
MITB.
You down with MITB? Yeah, you know me.
Whatever. Go ahead, finish it. You down with MITB? Yeah, you know me.
You down with MITB? Yeah, you know me. You
didn't say to me. Yeah, you know who? Me?
Me? Who? Me?
Who, me?
Oh, I don't know.
Who, me?
What happened to Money in the Bank?
You said that. Who, me?
Me.
Oh, Beetlejuice says it. Who, me?
Oh, yeah, but I...
Turn to me.
Okay,
who,
yeah,
me?
Yeah.
All right, so me? Money in the Bank from...
I'll bury that ass because I'm...
I'll bury that ass. Oh, Beetlejuice. Yeah. All right, here we go. So, Daniel Bryan. Got to talk about that, man. Yes. They're in Boston, Massachusetts. Daniel Bryan comes out on the pre-show. Now, let's talk about this. Daniel Bryan, do you think... If a guy like John Cena or a guy like Triple H was injured, you think they'd have him come back on the fucking pre-show?
Of course not.
Just goes
let alone get
you.
Interrupted, spoiler alert, when we get into it, by Bo Dallas. That's
by
his big
Bo
angle.
Dallas. By Bo
We put
Dallas.
A report up on the website, too, that the WWE is seriously considering bringing Daniel Bryan back as a mid-carder. Now, not so much a mid-carder in the sense that he's going to be a Dolph Ziggler.
They don't like him.
Not a Dolph Ziggler, but... He might even get the title again, but they'll never go with him as the guy.
They won't.
He's never John Cena. He's never Randy Orton.
They won't do it.
They won't do it. Fans are making it obvious that they should. They won't do it.
I think it's
the
look.
Same as CM Punk. CM Punk is the reason I started watching wrestling again.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
I had stopped watching. I was all MMA. When that pipe bomb happened and you told me about it, I remember where I was sitting. I remember what I was wearing. When you called me and said, yo, you have to watch this Punk promo. He's quitting next week.
Right.
He just shot on Raw. And I immediately said, no, he didn't, Ryan. You're falling for a fake shoot, this and that. And some of it was work shoot. I mean, the idea was work shoot, but he was really saying shoot things, which is what made it so cool feeling, because they hadn't done anything like that in a long time. Mm-hmm. And it was what got me back, and then there was like a contract signing with Vince the next week or something.
Right.
There was follow-up to it, and Punk is the reason I came back, and they never really ran with Punk. They gave him the title, let him break the record, the modern-day record, 389,000 days, whatever it was, as champion. But they never, he wasn't, it was Cena was still the guy.
Cena was always the guy, and then you had Triple H around, and it said during some of that time, you know, they were always the guys, one step above, guy like CM Punk. Hey, two things, CM Punk's WWE contract expires in July.
This month.
We believe it's July 17th. If it's not that exact
within
date,
the next 2 weeks.
If it's not that exact date, like Boone said, it's within those. It's within the next couple of weeks. So it'll be interesting to see what happens when his contract expires. Do we see him pop up?
Do they make an official announcement? We have come. Or, you know.
Future Endeavor post, do we see that on WWE.com, or does WWE re-sign him,
under the rug,
or does WWE re-sign him, which is very unlikely, but it would basically be a case of like Evan Bourne, although they wound up releasing Bourne, but it would be a case of you owe us some time as you walked out on our company,
they can think that
or you're
they
injured,
want.
It's not going to happen with CM Punk, so the best thing for them to do would be, listen, contract expired. Now, do we see CM Punk show up somewhere?
No.
Probably not. Probably
not. He's getting fat like me. He's gaining weight.
But he was out running the other day with AJ.
True. And AJ on Raw, we'll get into that later. My God, is she looking good.
Yeah, she does.
That's a pregnant chick? I don't know about all that.
I know you completely disagree with me.
No. I'm just saying, it's a funny line to say. Obviously, some girls, it takes months before they start showing that they're pregnant.
Right.
So she could still be, and she looks skinnier than ever.
No, they had her win the Divas title. Number one.
That's true.
Number one.
That's true.
If she's pregnant.
I'm just talking about her physical appearance. She could still look like that and be 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks pregnant, whatever.
If she was one week pregnant, WWE would not have put her in the ring. They wouldn't have put her in the ring.
They wouldn't.
She's not pregnant.
You're right.
Because even 1 week pregnant, you've got a little dot in there, one wrong
thing. It's still,
yes,
you're right. I didn't think of that. I was just thinking of the physical appearance. A lot of people saying, how can somebody pregnant look like that? Well, that doesn't mean anything. But the fact that they let her work, knowing that the risk involved,
you're right.
She's not pregnant.
Absolutely. And
there's no
way. Even winning the Divas title. Even
that or she's hiding it from them.
She wouldn't. They wouldn't. You know. She wouldn't risk that, I don't think.
It would be
she
stupid,
would be dumb to risk that.
Yeah.
Even when you're 1 week pregnant, you've got a little dot in your stomach. One wrong punch or bump or something like that, and that little that little dot is done. listen, I know you disagree with me. I'll throw it out there, and I don't think it's going to happen. I really don't. I just know if I'm CM Punk, and I'm pissed.
Start with the Ring of Honor.
I'm going to go there.
All right.
I'm going to go there. I know you disagree.
Can I take a nap while you do this?
You can take a nap. Let me see what the chat room thinks, okay? Go ahead. Let me talk with the chat room for a second, all right? Let me talk to you. All right. The snoring. No snoring.
Go ahead.
But listen, if I'm CM Punk, and put yourself in CM Punk's shoes. CM Punk, and I am pissed.
I am pissed
off at WWE. And you know I'm pissed off because I walked out on the company, okay? My contract is up on July 17th, therefore, around July 17th. Therefore, I can go anywhere I want. I can do anything I want. I can go to TNA, I can go to gym, not when your contract expires.
Yeah, even when it expires. That was proven with the guys they just released and shit, too.
Oh, well, the guys that were released not because their contracts expired.
Even when your contract expires, they have an on-compete built into it. We always talk about this. I really wish you'd look it up. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I think it's case by case. You're right. There's situations where guys, when their contract's released, they can do whatever they want.
I'm pretty sure.
I think big names like Punk, Cena, Bryan, you know, those guys, even Sheamus, guys like that, I'm sure they got it written in. If we really make you a star, you can't just go somewhere when your deal expires.
All right. Well, whatever. Let's just say, okay, his
well,
contract
okay, when he's
expires,
good and ready.
I believe when your contract is up, you are no longer obligated
okay,
to that
Okay, but that's
company,
not important, you said.
You
so
know.
Where's your...
It's not important. So let's say that his contract's up on July 17th. We'll go with that.
Let's say
and then he's got a 90-day no-compete clause, whatever. And
Either
he wins
way.
The 90 days. And he's pissed at WWE. We know he's pissed off.
what better way than, like, Winner's Lair in the chat, out of spite for WWE to say, you know what, you pissed me off, I would go to a company. I'm not saying TNA, because Punk's been against TNA. He's come out, yeah, last out against the Creed. But Ring of Honor, who's to say that CM Punk, even if it was for a couple of nights, a couple of dates, I'm not saying Ring of Honor would have to pay him all this money. Who's to say that CM Punk wouldn't go out there and return to Ring of Honor for a couple of dates for a cheap price?
Yeah.
Because what better way to give a fuck you to WWE, and we know that he's pissed. What better way to give a fuck you to WWE than to go back to Ring of Honor for a couple of dates?
First of all, I don't know that he's pissed. I know that he's not happy enough to continue working. That's two different things. He might be burnt out and not just, you know, and if he's burnt out, it's not like, oh, I'm going to go to Ring of Honor and say fuck you to WWE, because his motivation isn't fuck you WWE, it's I can't do this shit anymore for a while or something, you know. I don't know the difference. I don't know why he walked away.
The schedule in WWE compared to Ring of Honor.
No, I know it's a better schedule, but if he's just burnt out and just fell out of love with pro wrestling and said, I need time away, and that's his motivation, then it's not, oh, I need a way to fuck WWE, or I'm so pissed at WWE, that's why I walked away. He could have walked away for reasons that have nothing to do with being pissed at WWE. He might be unhappy with his creative. He might hate the road schedule, this and that, but that doesn't build up motivation to say, ooh, I can't wait till my shit expires so I can stick it up their ass. It could just be motivation to say, I can't take this shit right now, or I can't take this shit anymore, period. It might be what he's thinking even. I'm done. That doesn't mean I'm done, and then when I'm available, I'm fucking them. It means no. I'm done, and I'm done for now.
It's not the point of fucking them. It's that.
Well, that's what you keep saying. Became, what better way to say fuck you?
He became frustrated with the politics and the creative in WWE. He became frustrated. It's well known.
Yeah, but how much of that built into his walkout? We don't know.
No, but a lot of it. A lot of it. It's out there that he became frustrated with the politics and the creative in WWE. Said that they're way out of touch with reality. This is 2014. They're stuck in whatever land they want to be in. It's WWE land. He said, fuck this. I can't take this anymore. I'm leaving. He went. He took his ball. He went home. He's had time for a break. He's been at home. He's been going to hockey games. He's probably chilled out. He's probably cooled off. He's rested. He doesn't want to go back to WWE, because if he goes back to WWE, he knows the politics are going to be there. He knows what the schedule's like. Why not? Hey, the guy still loves wrestling. Wrestling's in his blood. So why not go to a company like Ring of Honor just for a couple of dates, a Saturday night, a Friday, or a Saturday night one weekend for Ring of Honor, and I'm happy. I get to work a couple of dates. I don't have to deal with the politics. I don't have to deal with the bullshit. And he still gets to wrestle.
You started this off by, I know you disagree with me, and that's where it's going to stay, because I don't agree with you at all. All
right.
I'm saying... The guy's, what, mid-30s, late-30s, mid-30s? 35, 36?
35, 36,
whatever
probably.
He is, he doesn't have 20 years left of his career. He doesn't even have 10 left in his career, realistically. If he's coming back, he's going to make the most money he can, not go to a rinky-dink shithole company, unless his sole motivation, like you said, is to fuck you, WWE, and shove it up their ass.
I think he's got money.
He's got money now, but you burn through that shit eventually, and he's, I don't think he's set for life got money. I'm sure he's got a couple million bucks.
Right, right.
After buying houses and paying taxes.
Well, Matt Hardy's a guy that worked in WWE, and he was just on Dave Meltzer's Wrestling Observer Radio and said that he made a couple of million in WWE, and he's set for life.
Well, he's set for life in the sense that he's got his house paid off. He's got enough money to pay the bills for the rest of his life. But certain people like that, they have a certain taste of life to where they have certain...
Matt Hardy was a drug addict. For Christ's sakes.
What does that have to do with anything?
I was spending money on drugs and doing other...
I'm saying he's got his life. He doesn't have to work ever again, meaning he doesn't need to work to pay his bills. But that doesn't mean he doesn't need to work to have a nice life as far as being able to buy nice things or do this for his kids, because his kids do this and that. You know what I mean? Like, he doesn't need to work to survive.
I'm going
to
ask
That's the difference between that and fuck you money. I don't think CM Punk has fuck you money yet. I think he's got... either very close to fuck you money or fuck you money. Let's even
maybe
say,
not. Maybe not.
Let's even
money.
Say he has fuck you money. The point being, if he's gonna put his body through hell again, because that is, you can't deny that as much as creative pissed him off and he got fed up with the WWE system, this and that. Another contributing factor was I'm tired of fucking beating my body up, traveling the 800 days of fucking year, you know what I mean? Slamming my body on a mat 600 times a year.
He doesn't want to do that anymore.
Exactly. So right. if he is going to do it, he's going to get paid for it. And Ring of Honor ain't really going to pay him for it.
But he's also, you're saying that the travel and the beat up bodies, Ring of Honor is only one or two nights a month.
That's my point. If that's what's bothering about WWE is all that stuff, yeah, then he could go to Ring of Honor. But he could go anywhere he wants. My point is, if he's willing to wrestle and put his body through hell again.
Right.
Because he's had a billion injuries, beaten to shit. That was one of the main reasons he wanted to quit. He was just overwhelmed, body had enough, travel, he was just ready for a break. If he's going to come off of that break, put his body through hell again, I'm sure he's going to say, all right, I can get paid $2 million a year, you know, just a regular number. $2 million a year for WWE, $200,000 a year from Ring of Honor. Why the hell wouldn't I add a couple zeros?
I don't think by working a couple days a month for Ring of Honor is putting your body through hell again.
You think?
I think
picture
it's
a Ring of Honor match with CM Punk. You think
right?
He's
and
take...
he goes for one weekend. It's not like he's got to be at a house
we
show
disagree.
On Friday.
Wow.
He's got to be at a house show on Friday, a house show on Saturday, a house show on Sunday. He's got to be at the Raw tapings on Monday. He's got to be at the SmackDown tapings on Tuesday. No, he's going in for a Friday night or a Saturday night match.
What
he
would
works
be the reason to do that?
Because he still loves wrestling,
so if
and he doesn't have to deal with the politics, and he doesn't have to deal with the bullshit, and he gets to work on his own time, on his own schedule, pretty much, and he gets to still have great matches with guys that he wants to work with without the bullshit and the politics.
If AJ Styles was able to go to WWE, do you think he would have taken that deal, or, oh, I want to have my own schedule?
AJ's come out and said that WWE's offered him a contract, and he said no.
In the past, he went to WWE and Ring of Honor both after this TNA thing, and WWE offered him shit.
Right.
So he said, no, fuck that. And he went to Ring of Honor because that was the better financial offer, not because... oh, I can set my own schedule, or I can have fun wrestling.
TNA was giving AJ more money than
Ring
of Honor's
paying
him. They
offered him a reduced pay when they renewed his shit.
Yeah, but still, a reduced pay in TNA,
yeah.
He would still have been paid more in TNA than he's getting paid right now in Ring of Honor. You think Ring of Honor's paying
because
AJ
Ring of Honor allows him,
TNA was?
Because Ring of Honor allows him to supplement their salary with Japan money. TNA doesn't let you go to Japan if you're on TV with
right,
TNA.
So he can work extra days.
This deal allows him to make more money than TNA would have offered. If WWE was offering more money, he didn't give a shit about, oh, I'm passionate about wrestling, I want to work here because I have better matches or lighter schedule, he would have taken WWE offering 2 seconds.
All
right. CM Punk has the ability to not only come back to WWE through the front door, but have him by the balls. Yo, I'm not coming back unless, and then... fucking,
right,
he's going to get a lot of those checks off of that list if he wants
right.
to do it.
We will agree to disagree.
Yes.
I think that CM Punk, that we may, I'm not saying it's going to happen, and honestly, I don't think it's going to happen. I think CM Punk is happy right now, and is at home with
his
money.
Let's ask this question
then.
If he ever comes back, where does he return? WWE, if ever.
I'm guessing that it's at some point we're going to see CM Punk back in WWE.
Well, why not Ring of Honor? It's a lighter schedule.
Why not Ring of Honor? I'm not saying that we're not going to see him in Ring of Honor.
If he comes back, let's say for sure 100% he guaranteed us tomorrow in a tweet. 5 years from now, I'm coming back to wrestling.
5 years from now, WWE. Probably.
2 years, with more or less, makes ROH more likely.
I would say right now he's still pissed off at WWE.
2 years from now. 2 years from now, I'm coming back to wrestling. Is he coming back to WWE's front door or Ring of Honor's front door?
I would say WWE. I would say right now he's still pissed off at WWE. He's had a chance to cool off.
If he said I'm coming back tomorrow, is he coming back to Ring of Honor or WWE?
If he's coming tomorrow, I'd say it's all up to him. That's an unfair question, man.
But
it's up.
You seem so sure that he's definitely. If he comes back, it's Ring of Honor.
I didn't say he's definitely. I said I don't think he's going to come back to Ring of Honor. I just said
that.
What
are we disagreeing on then? You said we'll agree.
We're disagreeing on the fact that I think. With CM Punk,
yes.
The way that he dislikes the politics in WWE, the way that he's frustrated in WWE, the way that he walked out on WWE, he's happy right now. The only reason that he can't go to Ring of Honor right now is because he's under contract with WWE. When that contract expires on July 17th...
Okay, on July 17th,
on July
he's coming back. Is he going to Ring of Honor or WWE?
I don't think he's coming back after July 17th.
So if a perfect world, he says, yes, I want to wrestle, I'm coming back tomorrow on July 18th. Is he coming to WWE or Ring of Honor? And if not,
I would say, you know what? If he's gonna come back, then why not go to Ring of Honor, work a couple of dates
That's different.
Work a couple of dates there, and then come to WWE after he gets to work for ROH a little bit.
Now you're saying a different thing. Now I would say
you're asking a question.
I'm asking if you're saying why not he go to Ring of Honor. Of course, there's an argument to make why he should. I'm saying what will he do, not what should he.
That's up to CM Punk. If I was CM Punk, what's our argument then? We're going to agree to disagree that I think
that
during
think
his
what,
off time,
I think the different
during ones. His off time right now,
yeah.
where he's gone from WWE, I would say when his contract expires on July 17th,
yes.
he's not going back to WWE anytime
yes.
soon. But before he goes back to WWE, if he ever has an intention of returning to WWE, before he goes back there, I say he goes to a Ring of Honor or a company like that where he can have some great matches with people he wants to work with. Fun matches. It would take, obviously, a pay cut. But before he winds up going back to WWE, I think we're going to see CM Punk back
somewhere else. So now your argument changed. Your argument is now...
No, you're asking a question.
My question is, what were we arguing on? Because you said we're going to agree to disagree, and I said it too. I thought the disagreement was, you think if he comes back into Ring of Honor, if I think he comes back to WWE, now you're saying, all right, if he comes
full-time
back...
Full-time or part-time?
Full time,
he's coming back to WWE.
Here's a question. If he comes back to the ring, will he ever wrestle in Ring of Honor? Ever. One time, 100 times.
Yes, if that's the question.
I say no.
That's where we did.
I had to help you find an argument because you didn't have one. You just didn't.
You're asking a question that could go multiple different ways. And I'm asking the reality of the situation.
If he says he's coming back, is there a chance Ring of Honor is where he's coming back to?
All right, we'll agree to disagree. I think we may see CM Punk back in Ring of Honor at some point. You don't. We agree
That's
to disagree.
The disagreement.
Well, Ivan, what do you guys think? You think maybe there's a possibility that we see CM Punk back in Ring of Honor during his off time right now with WWE? Or do you think if this guy comes back, he's going back to WWE, he ain't going nowhere
else? Just type
in
the chat, WWE or ROH.
No Japan, no Ring of Honor, no TNA. He's going. If he's coming back to wrestling... going straight back to WWE, or do you think before he would go back to WWE, would he work some Ring of Honor or Japan or any other matches? All right.
If he comes back, straight to WWE is my guess.
Straight to WWE if he comes back.
No
Nothing before that.
Nothing.
No Ring of Honor. All right, no doubt. All right. So, Money in the Bank from Money in the... Actually, I want to see the results.
The poll results. We got WWE, ROH, WWE.
A lot of WWEs, so they don't think...
ROH, you got two ROHs?
Well, some ROHs, but about four WWEs. A lot of WWEs. So if he comes back, a lot of people are saying he's going straight to
If he comes back, WWE, he's coming back too.
Maybe I'm a Ring of Honor. I love me some Ring of Honor.
Would I like to see it? Yeah.
It would help Ring of Honor out.
And you even said, should he? That's a different question, too. Should he? Fuck yeah, he should. That'd be awesome.
Right.
It would help the industry as a whole to give something to ROH that people would care about on a big scale.
Right.
It would be good for Punk because he would have fun, like you said.
Right.
Have some great matches with people he ordinarily wouldn't work with in WWE because they would never hire certain guys in ROH. You know what I mean? So there's a lot of reasons why he should.
More
WWEs. Will he? No.
More WWEs than Ring of Honor.
Yeah.
But I would say, just to leave it with this. If you're CM Punk and you really want to kind of slap WWE in the face and you go to Ring of Honor, it would be kind of a slap in the face.
You seem so sure that he wants to stick it to WWE.
I don't know that. I don't know that.
See, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Right.
If he did, then fuck yeah, Ring of Honor. He's not going to do TNA. That's too...
I think he's against TNA.
I think, yeah. It's almost like back in the day when ECW was the rebellious company.
Right.
If guys were going to leave, Heyman was like, if you go to WWE, all right, you're taking the money. If you go to WCW, you're fucking turning your back on us.
Right, exactly.
It's kind of like that with TNA these days. Like, why would you go to that shit company?
Right.
Even the hardcore wrestling fans think they suck.
When you know...
There's a whole different audience. There's three wrestling audiences nowadays. Because the hardcore TNA fans are going to go nuts at that statement. There's a WWE fan base... There's a TNA fan base, and then there's the diehard fan base. I say the diehard fan base is more ROH prone than TNA prone. I say the diehard fan base thinks TNA is a shit version of WWE. That's what I say.
Right.
I consider myself a diehard fan of wrestling, and guess what? I think TNA is a WWE wannabe. This is the way I word it. TNA is a bad version of what they think WWE is.
But I've seen
TNA is a bad version of what they think WWE is.
I agree with that, but in TNA's defense, there has been ideas. I agree with it.
No.
I agree with it, and I want TNA. I mean, listen, you can say all you want. We're just gonna skip Raw and Money in the Bank. We'll do that.
Just take the high points. Man.
Listen, you can say TNA sucks and TNA's garbage. This that TNA is gonna go out of business. For the sake, listen, all of us, you guys in the chat room, the two of us here, we're all wrestling fans, right? We all love wrestling. We all want to see companies succeed. So, yeah, TNA, you watch them on Thursday nights, Impact, it's garbage. It's been garbage. The creative hasn't been good.
Supposedly the NYC tapings were great.
We're going to talk about
that. Yeah, not only good, but great.
Hour two. But, say what you want about TNA, every single one of us should want a company like TNA to succeed.
And Ring of Honor.
And Ring of Honor. And
yeah, especially now that they're on pay-per-view. We didn't talk about that either. They're debut pay-per-view.
We want
best in the world.
Right.
Great show.
We want TNA to succeed. We want their
great show.
Very great show.
There you go. Put it over a little bit, man. It's your company.
We want TNA to succeed. We want Ring of Honor to succeed because it's better. If more than one wrestling company succeeds, ratings are probably going to go up for everybody.
The better the wrestling business does as a whole, the better.
More people are going
to
tune in.
The more money we make, the more product fans have to watch, the more quality product fans have to watch. It's a win. And the more money the companies themselves make, it's a win-win for everybody involved.
All wrestling fans win.
Everybody, even Vince McMahon should root for ROH.
Absolutely.
Even Vince McMahon should root for TNA. Even Dixie Carter should root for ROH.
More competition. Yeah. The more good creative writing that we have.
Plus, that's the more talent being developed that WWE can pick from, cherry pick from.
Guys are getting paychecks. Guys are getting good money.
More places for the wrestlers to work in the business. It's better all the way around for every company.
For anybody rooting for TNA or Ring of Honor to fail, you're an idiot. You're not a wrestling fan.
Yeah, no, you're a dickhead.
You're not a wrestling fan, is what you are.
What positive comes out of that situation?
Nothing.
They failed. Okay, what good does that do you?
It does nothing. Now we've got to start from scratch, like a Jeff Jarrett's GFW.
We got a lot of callers trying to get in tonight.
We're going
to
take live phone calls. Listen, real quick, we got to go to the break. We're already past 9
o'clock. Get out of here for an hour, for a couple minutes.
Money in the Bank. Let's talk about, before we go, the Money in the Bank.
Yeah, right? So Seth Rollins, John Cena, what else do you want to talk about?
The two ladder matches were awesome.
They
were
off the charts. Yeah. Which did you think was better?
I thought the mid-card one was
better. I did too. Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose?
Yes.
I thought that was better. I like the story of Ambrose getting injured and
injured.
Coming out at the finish.
How about the pop when he came back out?
They were popping and chanting for him to come out almost like they knew this is it. Because the second they started up with the chant, bam, he hit the ring like a bat out of hell. Wah! They exploded.
It
was great TV.
They exploded. Yeah. And I don't know if they had it planned for him to come out that early.
But
as soon as the crowd started chanting,
it was timed perfectly. It was almost like, you know how when you're in the Tonight Show or a game show, Wheel of Fortune, they have a sign that says applause, and everybody knows to start applauding because they're coming back for commercial, or somebody just won the $600 wheel spin, or whatever things are. They applaud, and they got the lights that light up. It was almost like the arena had lights that said, yo, Ambrose, and everybody said, Dean Ambrose, Dean Ambrose, or whatever they were
saying. And everybody thought that Dean had a shot to win, and then
Rollins. It was either him or Rollins.
There was a spot in that match where I think Rollins was up on the ladder, and there was a ladder down below, and he did a fucking suplex on the ladder.
There was a lot of bridge spots. There was a lot of bridge spots throughout that whole show, both ladder matches.
And real quick, on the pre-show, Daniel Bryan came out, cut a promo, and the one interesting bit that he mentioned was
the surgery.
I may need, they're talking about doing second surgery on my neck.
It reminded me of Cena coming out and talking about his elbow, but he was like shooting and saying, yo, see this guy? I've been hiding this.
If they do a second surgery on his neck, that's going to be neck fusion surgery. And if they do neck
Austin had, Lita, Edge.
And Edge is no longer wrestling. He's retired.
Austin was never the same. Kurt Angle's the only guy that's really come, and he didn't.
Right.
I don't think he ever had the fusion. I think he went to
a different doctor in Pittsburgh.
And that guy did some weird thing that he was back in like 2 months.
So these guys,
he's been fucked up ever since, and addicted to pain pills.
These guys have never been the same. So if Brian needs to undergo
and with his style. With
his style,
he'll never be the same.
I'm talking, there is talk in WWE, and I put it up on my Facebook, and a lot of people jumped all over me, that They're talking about his career.
At least a year to come back. If he comes back, he'll never be the same, and there's a chance he may never come back.
There's a chance he may never come back.
At best, he comes back and he's never the same.
That's why there are people. If he has
best,
to go,
he's gone a year, he comes back, he's never the same.
He's never
at
the
best.
Same. That's if he needs neck fusion surgery. But there are people in WWE, I put it on my Facebook page and on the websites, where his career is on the line. Look at a guy like Edge. Look at a guy like Austin. Look at Lita. They're all gone.
Oh, God, there's a many.
They're all gone.
Yeah, there's a lot of guys at the
neck. And if Daniel Bryan has to undergo that same thing, it's not good. It's not good. And not only that, but the way he's recovering right now is not good.
It's not encouraging.
They're saying he's got numbness in his...
He's not regaining the strength. Normally when you get the surgery like that...
It's not good.
Your arms are weak. You lose a lot of core strength, things like that.
Right.
And then, you know, you rehab, you recover, you work in the gym, you get your strength back. He's not getting the strength back, and it's only in one arm, so that tells you that the neck is pinching nerves or something, and they might have to go in there
It's not a matter of undergoing surgery like...
what I need for my back. It's level 3 fusion surgery. I need my L4, L5, and S1.
You guys...
He needs his C1, C2, something like that in his in his neck.
Right.
Mine's the bottom and the top spine of my... The top bone in my... The top disc or bone in my ass.
Right.
My tailbone and the bottom two of my spine and
so
the bottom
you're fucking
back.
With the tailbone
are smashed
spine.
Together. Right
good.
Where you bend. Yeah. Right, it's the worst pain in the world.
So anyway,
his
look
is right where you bend on your neck, and it's those three. And those are smashed. Now they need level 3 fusion surgery. You're talking about 3 discs. You're talking about screws and plates and fucking, you know, year of rehab.
There are a lot of people worried. We'll leave it at that. A lot of people worried with it. And you're going to see a guy like Wade Barrett. You see, he needs surgery, and he undergoes successful surgery, and he comes back 6 months from now. This is something... surgery.
Yeah, this is the granddaddy.
It's not your shoulder or knee surgery or you know, quad surgery, this, that, and the other thing. Neck fusion surgery, which is not a good one. So we're going to give you guys more on Daniel Bryan. We're going to talk WWE releases. We're going to run down Monday Night Raw a little bit when we come back from the break. We got to go a little bit over tonight, give you guys 20 minutes, half an hour, something like that. We'll go a little bit long for you guys tonight. A lot of news. I've been taking a lot of phone calls, too. I see a ton of phone calls coming up.
They're hitting the lines up,
So we will continue taking your live phone calls. No rapid fire tonight, so much news. We'll just kind of... Live phone calls. If you guys got a question, call us up tonight, and we'll do news and rumors. 518-712-3070. 518-712-3070. I see phone calls coming up left and right.
Come on here.
Not on the air right now. We're going to give 5 or 10 minutes. We'll come back on the flip side. Call us up live. We have a ton of phone calls tonight, so that's going to keep us busy, as well as all the news and the rumors. And if you guys have a question tonight, call us, 518-712-3070. You're listening to WCR-TV with Matty B, Ryan C. We'll be back right after this.
Sit up.
And we're back here for our numero dos. One more hour of this bad boy. We're going to... finish up Money in the Bank, and we'll pretty much run down the high points. No title changes at Money in the Bank.
Yeah, there was. The vacant title.
Oh, the vacant title, which was...
the main title? John Cena?
John Cena, it was John Cena winning the WWE titles. But I was surprised to see... Or WWE title. I was surprised to see the Usos against Luke Harper and Eric Rowan.
Yeah, me too.
I thought the Wyatt family was going to...
See, we didn't do a pre-show or a show before the week of Money in the Bank, so we didn't do predictions like we normally do. Or I would have totally creamed this guy, but...
Get out of here,
I've been losing lately. I was looking to get
here.
Some revenge this
weekend. Right.
I'm trying to think as we go along. I know I picked Harper and Rowan. I picked Paige.
We had Paige and Naomi. I mean, Paige wound up... Paige! There was a title change there.
No. That was on Raw.
It was on Raw. Okay, you're right.
Yeah, but I would have picked Harper and Rowan, so I would have lost. I would have picked Paige. I would have got that. There was no Adam Rose, Damian Sandow. Money in the Bank, I would have picked Seth Rollins. The world title...
It was between Rollins and Ambrose, you would have thought, right?
Goldust and Stardust, I would have picked those guys.
I mean, listen... Let's talk about John Cena and Brock Lesnar. There was a poster that leaked out for SummerSlam.
Before right? Money in the Bank.
Before Money in the Bank. And it leaked out and basically said that John Cena against Brock Lesnar was going to headline the SummerSlam page.
On Amazon, now, with WWE's official SummerSlam DVD artwork cover. So it was an official cover.
It was official.
Yeah.
As official as official can be. And
they subsequently released a news blast.
Right, you after that? It was over. Yeah. Right.
And no, before Money in the Bank.
Right.
The news blast was like, you know, there's been a preview of that cover for SummerSlam leaking around, you know. And it looks like that's what's going to be headlining SummerSlam. It was basically confirming.
So, a lot of people within WWE thought that because of that, they were going to pull a swerve. Right? Which they always do. And then you could always put the title on Cena at Battleground as you've got that pay-per-view in between.
Exactly. And it was the news blast that really fed all that talk because it was like when the Amazon leaked the SummerSlam DVD artwork, it was like, well, that's a mistake, an accident, whatever. When WWE confirmed it themselves with their own email blast.
All right.
You know, that's when it was like, oh, well, they're setting everybody up for a swerve.
Setting everybody up for
a
swerve.
Like you said, it would have made perfect sense because they're going to swerve them at last Sunday.
And then Money in the Bank and then going to Battleground and made Battleground, which is basically a throwaway pay-per-view.
Exactly. And now all of a sudden that throwaway pay-per-view has something.
Right. Yes. And they could have done the title change there, but we found out why they didn't do that.
At the same time, though, that would have been from going into WrestleMania, Randy Orton. Mm. Coming out, Daniel Bryan. Without losing... Let's say they gave it to Roman Reigns at Money in the Bank to do the swerve at Battleground.
Right.
You'd go from Orton to Bryan to Reigns to Cena to Lesnar at SummerSlam.
In a matter of like four or five months.
Like five title changes. That's too many.
That's way too many. You're right. So anyways, they wound up going with the original plan where John Cena, you know, won the Money in the Bank.
I commend them on that because a lot of times when things are predictable, even though they might be the right obvious thing to do, they're obvious for a reason, because it's the smart thing to do.
Right.
Just because somebody might know it's coming doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. There's a difference between, all right, we have to surprise and shock the people in this scenario, or this match, or this pay-per-view, or under these circumstances, or, no, this is getting us to where something more important, like SummerSlam, which builds to WrestleMania, that needs to happen the way it needs to happen. Not, oh, because they see it coming, we should switch it and make something that's less good. Happen.
Why does it have to be Brock against Cena?
It has to be Brock and a babyface.
It's got
to
be Brock and somebody.
Brock and a babyface.
And a babyface.
And you don't want to do Roman. And the only people on that Money in the Bank match that were babyfaces besides Cena was Roman Reigns. And I guess you could consider Bray Wyatt. Sheamus, but he's not winning.
But you had Jericho coming back for Bray. And we've already seen Bray
but
and
I'm
Cena
just talking about the Money
times.
In the Bank. All right, so the options are, if it's not, you said, why Cena?
Yeah.
If it ain't Cena, it's still got to be a babyface.
That's a Brock Cena, not Wyatt Cena.
Okay. If it's not Brock Cena, it's got to be Brock babyface.
Right.
And the only other options in that Money in the Bank match besides Cena that were babyface was Roman Reigns. Bray Wyatt would be the babyface against Lesnar. Anybody's babyface against Lesnar because of the streak.
Right.
But a strong babyface. Mm-hmm. Bray is like teeter-tottering, so he could have played babyface easy. So you could have either done Cena, Reigns, or Bray.
Right.
You could do Sheamus, but they're not giving the title to Sheamus.
Right.
Although it made sense if you're taking all from the Battleground. But alright, then you're left with Orton, heel. No matter what. Who else is in that match?
There's only one or two more, right?
We had Alberto Del Rio, heel. Cesaro, heel.
Right.
Kane, heel. Cesaro
would have made sense, but I don't think Cesaro would have made sense. Guys.
But you would have fucked Cesaro's push because he would win the title and then lose to Lesnar.
Right.
And then be, you know, like, and that's his big title reign.
I don't think Cesaro's at that point where he could be WWE champion right now, despite the
Or headlining the second biggest show of the year, SummerSlam.
You're right.
They got to build him before putting him in that.
So it would have been Roman Reigns or John Cena, and I don't think
Reigns is too early, and you'd be fucking him if you're gonna have him have a 2 month or a month reign and then lose, you know, Lesnar, because whoever faces Lesnar is losing.
They're not
having Lesnar's first match after defeating the streak be a loss.
Be a loss. Right.
Goddamn, I hope not.
Not only that, but you know that they were gonna do Triple H against Roman Reigns at
SummerSlam originally.
At SummerSlam. Now it looks like that's been pushed back.
They're talking Reigns Orton.
We're talking Reigns Orton right now. Yeah. And then they were thinking about pushing Triple H versus Roman Reigns back. Now you say, why wouldn't they do Triple H versus Roman Reigns? Why wouldn't they do that at the big show at SummerSlam?
Well, because Night of Champions is the big show.
We just talked about exactly. Yeah. Night of Champions is the big show. Now normally coming off SummerSlam. Coming off SummerSlam, Night of Champions was just kind of a throwaway show.
Before the
network. What we talked about earlier tonight in hour number one is you've got those six-month subscriptions that are going to be expiring around the Night of Champions.
Yeah, Night of Champions is the first pay-per-view after those expire. So basically you're trying to convince hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of people.
You need to stack. Not only SummerSlam,
the first show,
but you need to stack Night of Champions up because you want to make the people. You want to make the people when their network subscriptions are expiring.
Yeah.
You want to make those people have to re-sign and say, "Wow, Triple H versus Reigns, I need to see that."
You're saying, boom, they need to stack Night of Champions, yes, but they also need to stack SummerSlam. Technically, they don't need to stack SummerSlam.
SummerSlam sells by itself.
Some of them is already part of that six-month subscription, so that's with it. What you need to do, and that's why, and when people are like, wait, you're going to postpone Reigns, Triple H, the Night of Champions, and then do Reigns, or at SummerSlam, why not do the big match at SummerSlam? It's the big show.
Right.
Not anymore. The big show on the network is what comes when the subscriptions expire, or what's something we can get people to sign up for.
And what is WWE's main concern now? The network.
Yeah. Back in the day,
people to renew.
Back in the day, SummerSlam had a brand name, Royal Rumble had a brand name, where like when you were buying individual pay-per-views, the brand name would help people buy that individual show.
Right.
There's no more buying of individual shows. It's buying the network and what's in your six-month allotment. SummerSlam's part of it already, so technically you don't have to give them shit there. You should, because it's SummerSlam, but not at the expense of Night of Champions, which now becomes the more important
of the show. Well, they've got SummerSlam pretty stacked up in their defense.
No. It should still be a big show because it's SummerSlam. You still want big shows.
Absolutely.
Point being, it shouldn't be bigger than Night of Champions for the reasons you specified, which is Night of Champions is the hook to either get people to re-sign or sign up if they're already signed up.
Right.
But a lot of people will be coming up before Night of Champions. This is your first chance to get them back. You got to come off SummerSlam, a big show, with something that where you're like, oh, fuck, I can't wait to see it. This happen next. That's got to be Night of Champions.
You've
got
to
stack why Roman Reigns Triple H, which obviously sounds like a SummerSlam match, should be postponed to Night of Champions. As retarded as it sounds,
it should be on SummerSlam, but it also
the way people think now, it's still the old school model before the network, where oh no, the big match was on SummerSlam, Night of Champions is throwing. No, not based on the parameters we're under right now.
The parameters the network.
Yeah, the parameters we're under now is SummerSlam still needs to be big because SummerSlam is a big show and it needs to live that up. But not if it hurts. Not if you do it here. Night of Champions is lessened because you're either getting the rematch, which you've already seen, or you're going on to something lesser.
It's a business.
Reigns Orton here instead of Reigns Triple H here. Yeah.
Right.
You got to save your big shit for Night of Champions
Absolutely.
Now. So because of the network, technically speaking, Night of Champions becomes one of the big four pay-per-views this year.
This year,
SummerSlam doesn't.
Yep.
They're it does, but it's like Night of Champions is 2-2, SummerSlam's 2-B.
Pretty much.
You know,
exactly.
Night of Champions
that's,
2A.
That's a good. That's
SummerSlam's 2B.
Right.
WrestleMania's
right.
obviously 1.
It's a business before anything else, right?
Business motivated decision. Yeah.
And you've got to stack Night of Champions for the exact reasons that Boone just said. You've got to get people to renew their subscriptions when they expire, right before or right around Night of Champions. And what better way to do that than having a SummerSlam main event pushed back.
Yes.
To Night of Champions.
What better way to do that than save shit that you could blow off at SummerSlam and build it another month towards Night of Champions?
Right.
Using SummerSlam, a big show, which will feel big, to make what's coming up next at Night of Champions feel even bigger.
It's all about that network, guys. Yeah. It's all about that network. And the numbers are already well below what they thought originally going in. They thought they were going to be close to 1 million. And they drew 650,000 or something like
667,000.
You always got the number, man. Every
What's
time I
number?
Say,
yeah.
I always say 650,000 boozes. Nope, 667,000.
It's an easy number to remember.
Yeah. But anyways, so let's, Money in the Bank, it was school letter grade, A, B, C, D.
A.
I'm going to give it a good B+.
I'm going to give it an A.
Give it an A?
Straight A.
Not A plus, but A. You had Paige and Naomi. You had Summer Rae and Layla with Fandango as the referee.
Yeah.
Those were basically filler matches in between.
Well, the Fandango thing was full character. I thought Paige and Naomi wasn't great. No, wait, Paige and Naomi didn't happen, did it?
It happened.
Did it? Let me see it on there. No, wait, I think it did. You're right.
X'd it out.
I think Paige and Naomi did happen. Okay. Yeah. She won.
You had Cameron out there, and they kind of... They teased a lot of tension the week before on Raw.
Was that Paige and Naomi, too? Because Cameron was on commentary.
Cameron was on commentary. That was on Raw. That was
last
Raw.
Last Monday night. This past Monday night.
No, the week before.
Well, who did Paige work? Oh, Paige just came out for a promo on AJ, then came out and did...
Right. Paige did the promo on AJ.
So when did
AJ
Cameron do
back?
The commentary that
Cameron
we were
was
like, oh,
not,
God.
Cameron was not this Monday's Raw. It was...
Last Monday's. The go-long show that. For...
Yes.
Okay.
And they did a tease there that they were doing the split. And then, at the pay-per-view at Money in the Bank, you had Cameron out there.
Yeah.
But after it was over, Cameron just kind of... rolled her eyes, but
she
they didn't.
Unhappy.
She seemed unhappy that
she
lost.
Happy that Paige won. Yeah, or something.
Happy that Paige won. You know, happy that Naomi lost and Paige had won. But they didn't really continue the split at Money in the Bank. It was weird. They did more of a split.
What was the thing at Money in the Bank
Raw?
With the bomb.com? Because everybody
that was
just,
Raw. That
was
on
that
Raw.
Not just you, but there was other people I heard talking about. Oh, I should buy it. Was it bomb.com being the domain?
Bomb.com.
Real quick
is something.
Before you get into it, because Total Divas, that's a running thing. Why did everybody all of a sudden say bomb.com when they said, because I'm like, wait, she's plugged bomb.com 100 times on Total Divas.
On Total Divas, she always says, oh, that's the bomb.com.
So what made it different
they
on Raw?
They took it to Raw. What made it different is you've got 3 million people watching
so
Raw,
it.
And you've got 100,000
watching
Yeah,
but
Total
no,
Divas.
I've heard other people say, after hearing that, I almost bought the domain, and I'm like, but she's been plugging that domain on TV in front of millions of people already.
When she said bomb.com, I said, what the fuck is bomb.com? I went to bomb.com.
Really? Okay.
Now you're telling me it's all over Total Divas.
She says
it
all the time on Total Divas.
I didn't know.
Oh, God, it's so annoying. Yeah.
I had no idea. Cause
oh, that,
Total
that
Divas.
Piece of cheesecake was the bomb.com. You know?
Does she?
Oh, God, with everything.
I didn't know. So
remember
I'm
how
a lot of
Paris Hilton and, what was that little skinny bitch's name? Paris
Lindsay
Hilton
Lohan.
And, no, the other blonde, Nicole Richie.
Oh, Nicole Richie, right.
They used to always say, that's hot.
Yeah.
Remember
yeah,
that?
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the bomb.com. Anything that's cool or good or whatever, oh, it's the bomb.com. That's
well,
hot.
I didn't know what the bomb.com was. I went to bomb.com.
I'm sad to know this.
To see if it,
yeah.
And then they plugged it over and over and over again on
the bomb.com or bomb.com?
Bomb, that's the bomb.com.
Yeah, she's saying that's the bomb.com, the same way she would say
anyways,
that's the ProWrestlingScoops.com.
I went to the bomb.com to see if it was registered. I'm like, yo, either WWE, first of all, number one, they wouldn't be plugging it this much on national television unless
they
that was an unregistered
yeah.
domain or they own the rights. It's an unregistered domain. Basically, somebody owns it. But they charge you.
Well, it's registered,
you know,
yeah, but it's up for sale.
It's up for sale, yeah. And they charge you like $1 million or $200,000 to buy it, or it says $75,000
to buy it.
It's a nice
domain name because it's a catchphrase in pop culture. Like, yo, that girl is the bomb, bro, or, yo, that show
whatever.
Was the bomb. It's a lingo that
whatever.
People use. I think it's gay as hell, too, but I you hear people say, yo, that movie was the bomb, bro.
That movie was the tits, bro.
I say tits. Yeah.
All right, here
I
we go.
I stole that from a movie, too. It was I Love You Man is the movie.
You brought it up on here one night. You said, yo, that's the tits. I said,
no,
bro,
what? Every
what?
Once in a while, I get a catchphrase or a thing. Like, lately, I've just been going, dee.
Oh, my God. Listen,
yeah.
I'll be in there working.
I just try and get one little catchphrase or saying or noise or sound over, and I fucking shove it into my life. So much to see how people react, and eventually they either do it with me or they hate it.
I always
get a reaction if I do something.
I will be in there working on the computer. It'll be like 1, 2 o'clock
in the
morning.
One used to be holla back. Remember
yeah.
that one?
It'll be like
there's
one.
There's always something.
1, 2 in the morning. I'll be in there working. I'll be typing stuff up, and I'll hear D D.
You know what? That's for?
Over and over. I said, "What the fuck?" I start doing it back. D
D D.
You know, it goes on and on and on.
It's a very exaggerated
guy.
Version of back in the day on the Howard Stern show. Jackie Martling was the guy before Artie Lang. His job was to write joke, kind of what Benji does for the Stern show. Now Benji's the guy that got the finger up his ass.
Alright.
Alright, so he's got kind of the Benji job before Benji was there, and the Artie job before Artie was there. He was the third guy next to Howard, Robin, and then there was Jackie.
Okay.
And then Fred does the sound effects before Artie and before Benji.
Baba Booey.
And Baba Booey's the producer, but he, you know, he comes in every once in a while. But anyway,
Baba Booey.
Jackie would write jokes, and he was so insecure, and he was such a whore. He would always want plugs for his shows, because he would do stand-up shows. Plugs for his t-shirts and his CDs and this and that. He was just a whore. And he was so fucking selfish. Like, anytime he would write a joke, because that was his job, write a joke, slot next to Howard.
Jackie the Joke Man,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
He was just an woman, by the way, yeah, but go ahead.
So anytime he would write a joke and Howard would use his joke, you would know it was Jackie's joke because Howard would say the joke and then everybody
and
would, Robin would laugh or whatever, and Jackie would always emphasize. He would laugh at Howard's jokes all the time. Anytime it was one of his own jokes that he wrote, you knew it was because Howard would do the joke and he would laugh so obnoxiously loud.
Jackie would.
He would go, yeah, or like, you know, like, oh, those tits are looking great tonight. He would go, oh, don't. You know, he would make a big noise. Anything that he wrote that Howard would say, he would go, you know, and he would just do
that's
something
awesome.
Like that.
That's
so
awesome.
Now my thing is, all the time, I just
you just do it out of nowhere.
Very randomly. And I exaggerate it, too. I don't go, like, Jackie would go, I would go,
it's the most.
It's so annoying.
Thing. It's very annoying.
But I do
I'm
it over
there
and over
on my
and
computer
over.
And I do.
Yeah. All the time. Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Anyways,
get to our live chat room. WZROnline.com.
.com/chat.
WZROnline.com/chat. Get in there. Lots and lots of people in there tonight. All right, so Monday Night Raw. I guess we got to talk about the returns. First of all, the Authority comes out. They recap Money in the Bank from from Sunday Night.
Vicky Guerrero's farewell was since the last show, too, I believe.
They did it on the WWE Network on Tuesday night.
Well, it was a countdown, but I think we haven't even been there since the Raw thing where they did the mud match and all that.
Oh, the mud band?
Yeah.
Vicky, No, we did talk about that.
Did we talk about that? I don't seem to recall. Okay.
Because I remember saying
we plugged the countdown special. Yeah, you're right.
That they let Vicky kind of have her way, and then they had the Authority have their way. It was kind of evenly split. So
I think they let Vicky go out on a high note. Like, they let her get the last laugh. Which I thought was nice.
What do you think about Hector Guerrero coming out, bro?
With the speech about how Vicky disses the family?
Yeah.
That was a scumbag thing to do. Like, why would he do that?
I know, and Vicky did.
Like, even if it's true, why go to the public and be like, yo, why do that?
His main thing was Vicky sold out to the McMahon.
Okay. Why make somebody's family business public? Why do that?
But you know what? Vicky Guerrero was in WWE. She made money. And Shaw Guerrero's in WWE right now. And who's to say? I mean, why not? I think Vicky Guerrero, to her credit, I mean,
well, you're in the internet wrestling business and you make money. Why don't you just give it all to your sister?
Right. Given what Vicky has done, I mean, when Vicky
and if you
came
don't,
in,
how about your sister trashes you for not respecting the family? Like, wait, why make your family business public? Not right.
When Vicky Guerrero came into WWE, it was the wife, the widow of Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah, yeah.
Going out of WWE now, Vicky Guerrero is a character.
Big time.
A character in WWE that you are going to remember
and over
for years and years to come. And I feel like Eddie, rest in peace, brother, I feel like Eddie would say, you know what, I think Eddie knows that it's entertainment. And that, listen, granted, some of the things that they've done to Vicky on television, I think Eddie would have been rolling in his grave up there.
Hold on, I had a column on eWrestlingNews.com about Vicky Guerrero's run. And this was before she got her last laugh. And I was like, this was when we were arguing, not arguing, when we were both on the air, like, yo, they asked her specifically to stay a little longer to write her out of the story.
I know.
Just to fuck with her more. And I wrote a column before the last appearance. It was the week before the last appearance. It was the week she got barfed on by Stephanie and all that shit. And I'm like, they asked her to stick around just to fucking humiliate her more. That's just scumbag.
Eddie.
So I wrote that piece. But then I wrote a follow-up after they had her do what she did. And I'm like, you know what?
On her final night out.
Yeah, they put her over. On the way out, she got the last. She left laughing.
She came out to Eddie Guerrero's theme song after it was all set.
Early in the night, it was fucked up because they had Stephanie say some screwed up shit right to her face.
They
like, yo, the only reason you're here is because your husband died. Like, and she said it real mean.
Right.
And I was like, that wasn't necessary.
It wasn't.
You know, and then when I saw the mud bag.
A lot of things they've done to Vicky,
though. No shit, that's my point. They're all run, and then they give her, you know, but the big mud bath, I looked at that.
With Stephanie. Right.
Before they actually did the match, I'm like, God, now they're going to dunk her in mud on the way out, which they did.
They did, but she.
But she got to dunk everybody else, all the other three girls, and Stephanie, no exclusion. And Stephanie was a trooper. She got fucking doused in that
shit.
She got it. And she got to leave doing the shimmy, Eddie's music. She pointed up to the sky. It was a nice ending.
It was a nice ending, but there's been times in where they've completely embarrassed her, and they've mocked Eddie in the past, for Christ's sake.
There's been times. Her whole character was one that was an ugly chick that guys would pretend that was hot to get. She was the general manager.
Absolutely. They've called her a pig.
Edge would pretend to kiss her so that he could get a title shot, like, because she was the GM. Like, they were using her and making her look like a fat, ugly scumbag the whole time.
You're going to remember Vicky Guerrero as a character for probably the rest of your lives. Excuse me, and everything else. So they made her into a character. Not only that, but she's
and that's where Eddie would be proud. Eddie would look down and be like, she got over.
She got over.
My girl got over.
She's been given money to support her family, and not only that, but don't think for one second, if Vicky Guerrero was ever in financial trouble, I think Vince would be the type of person that, despite mocking her and everything on television, Vince would be the type of guy, same thing with Warrior's family,
I was gonna say,
where Vince is the type of guy where if they were ever in financial trouble, Vince would step
Dana
up.
Warrior was not a 9-year character on WWE TV, and he still took care of her and the kids.
Vince is still taking care of her.
Vicky
probably
put
9 years
in and helped make that company money. She was over.
Right.
She was one of the top heels in the company. Like it or love it, she was one of the top heels in the company.
She fucking hated that woman.
Whatever.
I think Warrior's family and Guerrero's family will be helped out for the rest of their lives.
Any family, but I'm just saying, Vince, especially in the case of Vicky, because. Right.
Not only
is it taking care of somebody that was very important, like Eddie, the same way Ultimate Warrior was very important. Eddie was very important.
Right.
Opened up the Hispanic market, et cetera, et cetera. Former world champion.
Right.
Vicky, not only is the widow of the deceased superstar, but she got herself over for 9 years. We're not talking about a couple weeks she was on TV. She was 9 years.
Got herself over with the stuff that she was given.
So she made a big contribution personally to the company, and her deceased husband did, her whole family heritage did.
Right.
So she's taken care of forever, but they're just the type of company that, and they don't get enough credit for this, they do right by families, they do right by addicts that need rehab.
And that, not only that,
they absorb all the costs for that shit. They gotta pay for rehab for Scott Hall nine times.
The producing for the Special Olympics. They have the Special Olympics
charity
kids
stuff.
Backstage.
They get promotion for that.
And things like that, dude. But it's
there's
it's
no promotion
like
for helping Dana Warrior.
No, there's not.
There is promotion for Special Olympics. There's no promotion for, you know what I mean? They do stuff like the rehab. There's no promotion for putting Scott Hall through rehab 9 times. And didn't Stephanie said it was in the high six figures of what they spent to put Scott Hall in rehab so many times?
And they don't ask for
promotion $1 million
for that either, right?
And they get no promotion for that. They get no thank you, pat on the back for that.
Right.
It's just something they do. And Scott Hall is not in that company anymore.
Right.
But he did, and he was only in it for a couple years.
And they
four years. They
send out that letter every year.
He was only in it 4 years. Yeah, any company, any guy that's worked for the company ever, will put you through rehab if you need help.
Right.
That's huge.
They're a good company behind the scenes where they've done a lot.
They've got their
people.
Goods and bad points, but they'll get a credit for a lot of good shit they do, yeah.
Right. Let's see, Rob Van Dam, Seth Rollins. I thought that was a really good match on Raw, dude. They tore the house down. Let's see here. We had what else happened? The Wyatt family against
the Battle Royal
and Sheamus
for the Intercontinental.
Is that what that was?
Yeah, I think so. They announced the Battle Royal for the Intercontinental title.
Wade Barrett had surgery on yesterday.
I don't know, it was a day or two ago. Yeah, okay. But for separated shoulder.
Separated shoulder.
It's going to be out several months, it's being said.
About 6 months, right?
Yeah, several months. Yeah, a long time. Not like he's going to be back in a month or two. He's out for a while. He just came back. And Bad News Barrett was the character of the game when he came back from injury.
Dr. James Andrews did the surgery down in Birmingham.
That was the one who talked about it. It was a different doctor.
He was in Birmingham, Alabama.
That would be James Andrews.
You're right. He was in Birmingham.
I could swear it was a different doctor.
And then it was the WWE doctor that came on.
They talked about it, Chris Amon. But no, I think it was a different doctor. But you might be. If it was where?
Birmingham,
then that's Dr. James Andrews. Yeah, he did Bo Jackson and all this.
He's going to be out about 6 months. So
Yeah, no matter what, he's out a long time.
So they announced the Battle Royal?
Vacant Intercontinental title. I guess that'll take place at Battleground.
Battleground, right.
Probably the only reason they did Battle Royal, Battleground.
Battle Royal, yeah. Battleground, right. How many Battle Royals have we seen?
We just saw the IC title in a tournament.
Right.
And that's what Bad News Barrett won to become the champion. And now, 2 weeks later, 3 weeks, whatever it's been, it's vacant again in a Battle Royal instead of a tournament.
We had the one in Albany on Raw, the 20-man Battle Royal, where it came down to Sheamus throwing out Ambrose.
That was for the U.S. title.
Right, for the U.S. title.
So they've had a title. They've had a Battle Royal for a title recently, yeah, a secondary title, U.S.
Right.
IC.
Right.
They've had the tournament very recently for the IC title, pretty much the same time the Battle Royal for the U.S. title was going on. And now it's up again in a Battle Royal. And the first seed was Cesaro, Paul Heyman said.
Right.
Which I don't know what that means. Maybe there's no entrant number one, number 30. It's not a Royal Rumble. It's a Battle Royal. They're all on at the same time.
I got to switch subjects real quick. Bo Dallas. He's growing on me, bro.
I like him. I've been saying it for weeks.
He's growing on me, man.
I said when we first saw the vignettes, I said just based off the vignettes without seeing the debuts or the promos, just off the vignettes, I said Adam Rose is going to get a cult following.
Right.
Bo Dallas.
Completely fail.
He'll be back in NXT or fired or just being a total comedy jobber that fails.
I said Adam Rose. Wait a minute.
I said Adam Rose
is going to be over. I said I think the fans are going to take after him. Adam Rose is going to be the guy. I said Bo Dallas is going to be a complete failure.
You had nothing to
do. I have completely reversed. I think Adam Rose is going to be a complete failure. And I think Bo Dallas...
Kind of already is.
I think Bo
Dallas is doing this right now.
Dude, all you got to do is the way... The delivery.
The victory lap.
The delivery,
the
bro.
The delivery is the key.
The delivery is the key.
When he gets on that mic and he's talking like this.
Yes. That's it.
My favorite thing he ever did was during a match. I think it was, forgive me, it's not Kofi Kingston. Let's just say it was Kofi Kingston.
Okay.
He's kicking Kofi Kingston's ass and the crowd's booing or something and he says, "Don't you boo him! Don't you boo him! He's trying his hardest!" Or something like that. I laughed my ass off, bro. I was like, "Yo, that's so fucking funny."
It was
good.
He
said, "Don't boo him! He's trying his hardest!"
Right.
I was like, "Oh, while he's kicking his ass."
Came out at the Money in the Bank pre-show. He says, "Don't worry, Daniel. Just don't worry.
All you gotta do
is believe." And then I thought Daniel Bryan's line about the boner
was written.
Was corny. And
obviously, it was written.
All you gotta do is bow. Leave. I thought that was cute.
I thought it's the same word. You just believe.
Hesitate a little more in the word.
You know,
and then
leave,
he came out. Leave. Then he comes out on Raw, right?
The boner. The boner. I thought was stupid.
This is what I didn't like.
No addressing of the boner.
The boner.
They're trying to make that the chant.
It trended on Twitter and everything.
That's
else.
What Daniel Bryan called him.
Well, he came out on Raw and he got down on one knee and he says, "I want 60 seconds of." Bow silence?
Here, let's start the clock. You want to see what 60 seconds of silence feels like? Hold on.
You get really going to do this? You're going to give
starting
60 seconds?
Right now. That's how long he was silent.
That's how long it went on. And they did this on
for
Monday
the full
Night Raw.
60 seconds.
For the full 60
seconds.
That's
when seconds. You know 3 hours is too fucking long.
You got a minute to spare in three
a
hours.
A minute to spare, man. That is the longest minute ever.
What do you got? 180 minutes. And then you take out 1 minute where he just got down on one knee and said...
It's actually 44 minutes times 3. What would that be? 88
You've
minutes.
Got the commercial breaks, right?
88
factor into
plus
those.
44 is what? That's shit, that was deep. 90s. I can't do it. 88 and 44 as well.
Anyway, I thought that was terrible on Monday Night Raw.
Yeah, they got 132 minutes.
Right.
Of live, like, without
of live television.
Not including the overrun. 142, whatever the number I just said, add 10 right. minutes to it. Yeah, so a lot of time.
By the way, there was a backstage segment. I think it was a Money in the Bank. Brie Bella was backstage. Stephanie came up and said, what is Brie doing?
That was Thunder. Here.
That was Money in the Bank.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think what they're going to do is Stephanie McMahon against Brie Bella. Or Stephanie McMahon against Nikki Bella, right?
Yeah.
At WWE.
Brie. Now, what they should do is...
They may do Nikki, and then...
If Nikki wins, Brie gets her job back.
The stipulation
that
would be...
That should be what they do. Right. The talk is Nikki versus... Brie versus Steph.
Brie versus Steph.
If Brie loses, she's fired, even though she's already fired.
Yeah,
that makes any sense, but,
Well, if they do Stephanie versus Nikki, okay, at the pay-per-view... Brie gets to
that
come
makes
back
more
in
sense.
WWE, or if they do Stephanie versus Brie and Brie defeats Stephanie, she gets
her
job.
The same way that was thinking
they can do
that
it
too.
Either way,
but they would have to very make that clear in this. They can't be like, "Oh, you're rehired for a match
right,
that
right,
you
right.
either lose your job or you stay rehired."
Either way,
I think what they're gonna do is
Brie's
like you
gonna
said
be back.
With Goldust and Cody Rhodes. If you remember, I think it was just Goldust.
Uh-huh.
He had a match
remember
with
this,
the Dusty
right.
Rhodes and all that yeah. when they were firing the Rhodes. When the Authority kind of first started around. If Goldust wins, he gets his job back in the WWE.
Right.
He ended up winning.
Something like that.
He's still here to this day.
Either way, Brie's going to be back. I mean,
of course.
They didn't need to take Brie off television. They didn't know Daniel Bryan was going to have
the whole reason they did it was,
evidence.
Yeah, so he didn't surrender the title, and then he surrendered it anyway.
Right.
Like a week later.
Thought Kofi and Cesaro had a good match on Raw. A lot of good wrestling on
Raw. It was a good show in general, yeah, man. It was just a good show, I thought.
We had
Damian Sandow came out as Vince McMahon.
This is well. Let's talk about the Miz and then Chris Jericho. Let me tell you something.
Well, before where was it? Real quick, Damian Sandow came out as Vince McMahon.
Oh Jesus!
Just to plug my e-wrestling news column, I put a
hey. Go ahead.
eWrestlingNews.com, I put a column up a couple days ago. The one I did today was different. The one I did today was on Emma, which we'll get to.
Right.
On Emma's, that whole system.
Can I just say something? Let me catch you up.
Just real quick. It takes 2 seconds.
Who's
Damian
column?
Damian Sandow, it was called, Who Did This Guy Piss Off? And it was a picture
awesome.
Of Damian Sandow and
awesome.
The interpretive dancing gimmick. So, yeah, that was the column. It was about, like, yo, he does so good with these shit roles. He did so good as Mr. Money in the Bank. He did so good as the revised 2014 version of Hunter Hearst Helmsley, the rich snob. Mm-hmm. He did so good with everything they've given him. Why don't they give him something real? He's got so much talent, and he's so... Oh, why not?
I will say this. Matty Boone's columns on eWrestlingNews.com, I'm telling you, his columns are awesome. I don't read columns. I don't like reading columns. I just... A lot of times, I don't have the time for it. You put up the Sandow column with who did this guy piss off? There was a photo that you...
Great photo, right?
The photo, dude, it had me laughing out loud, dude.
Yeah.
In addition to that, go read his columns, eWrestlingNews.com.
Thank
By
you.
The way, you are now working
for the
MMA
the website, yes.
and UFC website that just launched. Frank... is doing, you know, he's now launched basically a sister site of EWN.
And they look exactly the same. It's just
it's
one for wrestling, one for MMA.
It's called eFightNews.com. Matty Boone is the main guy, the head guy in charge over there. eFightNews.com, it just launched today.
Yes.
And Matty B is
We're
the main guy.
We're still getting
in charge
it going. I mean, we literally just hit the ground today, so it's
right.
not anywhere near what it will be, but much like. Ryan Clark runs eWrestlingNews.com and has for fucking 10 years, whatever it's been. I run eFightNews.com.
I don't run it, but I'm the head reporter.
You
Frank,
run eWrestling News.
Frank is a great guy.
You don't own it, you run it.
Employed the both of us.
You run
but,
it.
I mean head news reporter, but...
He runs eWrestling News. I'm going to run eFight News, and that's what we do now.
eFightNews.com. Check it out, man.
On top of my already existing jobs. And I won't be quitting my columns. I'll still be doing my columns.
Still be doing the columns,
for
too.
For eWrestling News, so you guys can still read that stuff.
All right, we had, The Miz... All right, first of all, who was on was it Justin Roberts, I think? I think it was Justin Roberts. So he announces that... A former WWE champion who has had
multi
success outside
basically
of WWE.
Basically, he's had success in and out of the ring.
All right, so The Miz comes out, and on the websites we had put up earlier in the day, Chris Jericho is coming back to Monday Night Raw tonight. So the announcer, I think it was Justin Roberts, he says, please welcome The Miz.
Yes.
And The Miz comes out.
Dude, it was funny, we had first reported Miz or Ric Flair was our initial reports. And then we heard the day of the show, no, it's Chris Jericho. Yeah.
That it was Chris Jericho. So they bring The Miz out. I am telling you, my Facebook page blog, those of you in the chat room or listening live that follow my Facebook page, I have never gotten so many comments.
I don't even know.
Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR, Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR, Facebook.com/MattBoonWZR, Facebook.com/MattBoonWZR. I am telling you, The Miz came out, and I had so many comments like, yo, Ryan, you gotta be fucking kidding me, man. You can't be serious.
Dude. Our initial, and you'll
you
be,
said
we'll
Jericho.
See if, you'll see, we'll see if you're honest. Our very initial reaction as far as audible was, oh, what the fuck? But then 2 seconds later, we were both in agreement. As Miz, he didn't even start talking yet. He was still coming to the ring.
I said, that's not
you
it.
You popped in my room, and you're like, he's still coming. And I'm like, yeah, no, he'll cut him off. We both knew it was coming still.
Winners live in the chat. Mark got treated worse than Hitler after that post. Everybody jumped on my
Facebook. You're wrong!
You were wrong!
Yeah, did they
Why
do
would you do that? You lied! Wrong again! The dirt sheets are always wrong. And I replied on the thread. I said, guys, the segment's not over yet. I said, wait a minute. Just give it a minute.
Did they kiss your ass?
Miz goes and cuts promo. Jericho's music. The
pyro. Oh, wait, what do you mean Jericho's music?
Jericho's music hit. The pyro hit. So his music hits, and everybody says, my bad, my apologies, I owe you an apology, this, that, the other thing. You knew, and even our reaction, like you said, was, alright, Miz is coming out, but somebody's going to come out and cut him off. Now, I didn't expect the Wyatts to come out.
I didn't expect that.
I thought that we were going to have a Miz-Jericho feud, they were going to go back and forth on the microphone. And then we're probably going to lead us into a Jericho-Miz match at either Battleground coming up or SummerSlam, one of the two. Wyatt's wind up coming out. By the way, Jericho was great in his role.
Yeah.
He said on his podcast,
a couple of brief comments.
If you guys haven't read the post on the website, we put it up. Jericho went on his Talk Is Jericho podcast, basically revealed everything that happened with the McMahons. He said that they had loved the segment. Triple H, Stephanie, and Vince all loved
the segment.
Oh,
you're talking about after
the
debut. Right, after the latest show. Yeah.
Right. Basically said that he had been in talks with WWE for a while now.
And it's pretty clear that one of the reasons he came back was because, you get to work with the Wyatts?
You
like, alright, I'll do
Wyatts.
That. Right. He didn't want to come back and do Fandango Part 2, you know what I mean?
And Jericho's the type of guy, and he's admitted this on his podcast, where if he sees a guy, an up-and-comer, that he thinks is going
to
be the next big thing,
he claims to take credit for him. He claims to be like, to be able to, he claims to be able to spot the next stars, and I always predicted he would be a star.
And then put him over?
Yeah. No, but he does.
He
does. Track record backs
You're
up
right.
what he says, but
You're
he
right.
he's very quick to tell you, like, no, I picked the next generation of stars. And
so
I'm always right.
When they
and
told
he is.
Him, when they told him that he was going to be back and he was going to be on a long-term program with Bray Wyatt, he said on his podcast that he was very open to doing that.
Yeah.
Come back, they would do
well,
a match.
Anytime you hear any of these guys, Austin, Jim Ross, Jericho, the blog guy, the podcast guys,
right.
Or big names from the recent past that just recently retired, like Rock, whoever. Rock would be a bad example because I haven't heard him say it. But guys of that era, they all say the same thing. When they talk about modern-day WWE, who's the names they bring up? Daniel Bryan, The Shield, The Wyatts. That's it.
Right.
Some bring up Cesaro.
Well, you know what else
they bring up? Cesaro.
You and I talked about it yesterday. They're always talking about,
And Dolph Ziggler every once in a while.
These former WWE stars, they always say, well, everybody remembers that match from 1992.
Oh, no, we're talking
in 1994,
about... 1994... Yeah, we're talking about Hall of Famers, legends from the past, like old guys, like anybody on Legends House, The quote I will always hear.
Everybody's still talking about that match, right?
There's a different quote. It's very close to what you're saying. What there's is a it? Quote that they all say, and it's word for word verbatim this.
Everybody's still talking about.
I still hear people talking about that to this day. To this day, I still hear people talking
ain't
about
that. Ain't nobody talking about that, though. What are you talking about?
To this day, I still hear people talk about my 1986 hair versus hair match on Saturday Night's Main Event.
Nobody's talking about that. Nobody's talking about last week's Raw. What are you talking about?
Nobody's talking about that. You can Google it, and there'll be talk about it on the internet. Right, yeah, right. But that's for historical, archival purposes. They're not like, to this day, like, man, I can't believe that match 26 years ago. I still can't get over it.
No. Ain't nobody talking about that.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
I wish I had the soundboard up, man. I wish I had the soundboard up.
A web browser.
All right. So the Jericho Miz stuff was really good. The stare down with Jericho and the Wyatts was great. Right. What do you think? Maybe Ric Flair coming in. I mean, there was talk of Ric Flair managing the Miz.
Well, I mean, Jericho and Bray's obviously going off this way.
And
Harper and Rowan, I think, are still doing the Usos thing.
Ric Flair has been open in interviews. Somebody recently, a fan, had emailed us and said that he met Ric Flair a couple of weeks ago and said to Rick, "Yo, you should be the guy that manages Dolph Ziggler." And Flair turned Flair turned to the fan and said, "Yo, I've tried, but WWE simply will not budge."
Isn't that a shame? Because he could really get Ziggler over to that next level.
I think Flair and Ziggler, yes.
Ziggler's done the gimmick where he's won the suit, he's been the pretty boy guy, the successful, I'm better than you, suit wearing, arrogant.
Flair could
He's done that perfectly. If you put Flair with that same gimmick, money. You can print money.
They don't like Ziggler. He's got the Daniel Bryan syndrome. Worse.
I think Daniel Bryan's starting to catch a case of the Ziggler syndrome. I think Ziggler is so pigeonholed and looked at a certain way.
Do you hear the crowd chant for Ziggler week after week after
week, man? The pop, the second his music hits, they fucking go nuts.
Anytime he's in a battle royal
where something's at stake.
They want him to win it.
They're salivating for Ziggler to be the guy.
And they won't pull the trigger on it.
Yeah, it's very rare where Daniel Bryan would be the best example recently.
Right.
Where it's so obvious that the fans are telling a message, or are sending a message to the WWE brass and saying, "This is our guy. Please." And they won't give him anything.
Well, with Daniel Bryan, they ran with it and they gave him the title.
No, they gave Ziggler it too. He had the Money in the Bank briefcase. The night after WrestleMania, he won the world title. Loudest pop I've ever fucking heard. He was a made man. He got the concussion. Took the belt off of him, and they have never done shit with him since.
And it may be the same thing with Daniel Bryan.
That's my point. Same as thing the as Daniel Bryan. Right, they gave Bryan the title and did what everybody was begging for, the fans. And the reports we're hearing is when he comes back, he's not going to be this anymore. He's going to be, you know, not mid-card,
but in between the
mid-card and the main events where he's...
You bring up a great point, man. Dolph Ziggler got the world title, got injured.
They started his thing, too.
They started his thing to
injured
the top.
One injury later.
The crowd wanted Ziggler. They gave him the world title, right? He gets injured. He comes back. Look at him now.
Hasn't been the same. Daniel Bryan. Not even close.
Daniel Bryan, he wins the WWE title.
That'll be different.
He gets injured.
That'll be different in the sense that when he comes back,
he's already established as a main guy, so
he'll be in that position where he's not a mid-carder,
right?
He's not the main event or the most important thing. He'll be somewhere in between there.
It's almost identical, although Daniel Bryan's a little bit higher up than Ziggler.
He's a bigger version of what that
it's
is.
It's almost
yeah, same
identical.
Thing, just right. higher up on the card.
Right, right. You're right. You're absolutely right.
I'm always absolutely right.
Try to put you over, and you got to make a little fucking.
Sorry, I speak facts.
Put yourself over.
Put yourself over.
Fucking jackass.
Fucking guy. All
right, we had Dolph Ziggler Fandango. We ain't gonna talk about that. Goldust Stardust defeated Rybacksel. The great Kali or AJ Lee Paige. We talked about this earlier.
Paige came out, cut a promo. AJ, pretty much same thing as the night after WrestleMania. AJ came out to congratulate her, shake her hand, quote unquote. An impromptu match started up. AJ wins, gets the title.
Right.
And she was looking fucking scrumptious, if I may add. She looked amazing.
We had the main event of her little tiny body, bro.
Oh,
stop it.
Oh, my God in heaven.
Jesus, you want to jack one out? I'll walk out.
Put a picture up in front of me right now of AJ Lee. I could probably jerk off on camera.
I'd people don't want to see you.
No, I don't want to do it. I'm just saying that's how hot she gets me. She's hot.
You got 7.5 inches? They already know you got 7.5 inches. You told us all a couple of months ago.
3/4, but yeah.
7 inches and 3/4. Right, yeah. So this motherfucker, you really took a tape fucking measure
to your thing.
And got the 3/4.
No, I didn't. No, I told the story on the show before when we were not kids, but I was about 16.
Let me hear it.
When I was about 16, my mom, we had seen it on Howard Stern on the E! Show, and my mom reenacted it. We had this girl, Belinda, that lived with us. It was Belinda and Chris and their kids. William, Wade, and Josh were
all right.
Three kids. And William was the oldest, Wade was the middle, Josh the youngest. Belinda was the mother, Chris was the father. I was 16 at the time, maybe 14 or 15, but it was right around that age. Right, those ages are foggy for me. I did a lot of drugs back then, sorry to say. Hardcore drugs, too. But that was back then. So they send all of us. Tim, my stepdad, Chris, Belinda's husband, me, Steven, you know Steven, my brother, Mike, you know Mike, my brother, all of us one at a time in the bathroom with Belinda. And she would let us feel her tits and this and that to get a full fucking I'm throbbing erection. And we'd measure them. And at the time, that measurement was...
With what? A tape measure or a ruler?
Not one of those you use on a construction site with a big metal casing. It was one of those that wraps... Not one of those. It was one of those that wraps into a like a tape that wraps...
Okay.
Yeah, one of those kind of tape measures.
Okay. Throw
the whole tape out, and then you get the, you know, and you do that with it.
All right, so you're into a full erection. You're into a full erection.
In the toilet, in the bathroom.
And you unroll the tape. Right, you unroll the thing and you just line it up. And you
well,
say,
she
oh, okay.
did. She did.
That's seven.
So
and
she did the measurements so that we couldn't lie, like or give herself extra. She would measure right from the base to the tip, and that was it.
So that's
balls
seven.
Included.
I'm gonna give you Boone. I'm gonna say that's 7 3/4.
It was 7.5.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. That was fuck. I was. We'll split the difference. We'll say I was 15. I'm turning 30 next week. That would mean. Half of my life ago. 15 years ago.
15 years ago.
15 years ago.
All right.
And you don't grow after 15 as far as I know.
I can honestly tell you.
I had already hit puberty and stuff. So.
I can honestly say to you, I have never, in my time where I've been watching porn and gotten... I have never... Well, you were feeling tits and...
I wasn't trying to jerk off.
You were participating in porn.
I was specific... What was it? Purposely getting turned on by a girl
right.
for a measurement.
Just to see a measurement.
Yes.
Well, I can honestly say that I've never done that, and I've never taken a tape measure to my penis and measured whatever.
Okay. I have.
Okay.
Everybody in my family has.
Has anybody done that in the chat room? Have you ever taken a tape measure to your dong and said, whoa, it's about 8 inches tonight? What? Anyways... Get to our live chat room, WCROnline.com/chat, WCROnline.com/chat. All right, so Monday Night Raw, dude.
Teresa said she would help me and she would measure it.
She would help you?
That's what she said.
Bring her on up.
Bring her on up.
All right, we had Monday Night Raw. Main event was John Cena, Roman Reigns, Randy Orton against
Kane. And it got busy near
Kane.
The end of this. Yeah.
It did get busy.
Where was
Seth
your big
Rollins?
Kali return at? You missed that.
We don't even need
exactly.
to talk about that.
Who remembered it? I can't believe you remembered it.
It was a big return.
Literally speaking, because he's
That's
big.
What I'm saying. But a lot of stuff happened towards the end of this, man. Seth Rollins ran out. He was about to
You really him. Got the impression that he was, because, yeah, Cena was fucked up, and you got the impression that, holy shit, Seth Rollins is going to become the world champion right now.
The night after a pay-per-view,
yeah.
you know,
I can't picture
are...
a year from now Rollins cashing in and being the guy, the right. champion. I still can't picture it.
Right.
Do I think he has the talents that deserve that, that warrant that?
I think so.
Absolutely.
Hey, by the way.
Without question. But I can't see WWE putting that much faith into him yet.
Between
so
Money
really
in the Bank.
They're really going to have to go this way with him for a year before they cash in.
Between Money in the Bank and Raw, let's take the three Shield members, right? Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose, and Roman Reigns. Give it up for Dean Ambrose, dude. He has
got
a couple of promos.
Dean Ambrose.
Right.
Is back to being the guy that I think is going to be the breakout star of that group.
I've said it all
His
along.
Promos are... They're so different.
Dude, he is...
They're so different.
Oh,
they're
he's
not
cold,
the
bro.
Typical... I don't even know how to explain it, but they feel different.
Right.
They're delivered different, executed different. they come across different on TV. There's just something different about what he does, and in a good way. It's very different, but very unique in a good way. Like, it's very like, yo, that's different, and that's cool.
You know, he cut that promo on Raw where he basically told Rollins that every time you've got that Money in the Bank briefcase, and every time you come out to try to cash that in,
that's a unique storyline. I think that's creative team writing. It's not his performance ability.
Right.
Had trouble swallowing there.
But every time.
No, anytime that he performs, anytime they say, here's your script, or here's your bullet points, whatever they do with him, his delivery, A+, off the charts, 100%, two gold stars. You know what I mean? Two smiley faces, stickers on your report card. You know what I mean? Like, he's the man.
Okay.
But they're also giving him good shit, because that storyline that you just mentioned, where he goes out of his way to say, it's okay I didn't win the Money in the Bank briefcase, it actually works out better this way, because I'm going to take great pleasure anytime you go to try and run in and screw somebody over and sneak a title reign in. I'm going to fucking be there and take you out.
Taking you out.
And it started on Monday with Raw. Rollins comes out with that briefcase. Looks like he's going to beat Cena. Holy shit. Here comes Ambrose.
And Ambrose came out. And I got to be honest with you. I forgot about the promos. I forgot about the promos.
Everybody's claiming, like, no, that was obvious. Obviously, Rollins is going to pretend to cash in. Ambrose is going to stop him. When Rollins came out, I thought for sure for a split second. And then when he got there, it was obvious the second he hit the ring, by the way, the action was looking. But it was like, wow, like, he's going to catch and win the title. The I forgot about the Ambrose.
You know what? The night after a pay-per-view, the biggest Raws of the month, it makes perfect sense.
You need that tweener champion. It's Swerve off of Cena, who obviously everybody was expecting in the first place.
Exactly.
With that poster, that news blast. Right. Here's your wrench in the plans.
They would do the Swerve and the other thing. And then Ambrose, sure enough, wound up coming out. And they did a beatdown. It was
so awesome. Now every time you see Seth Rollins cash in.
And not only that, but let me say this. When they split up the Shield, I came on here and I said, I don't like the idea of a Shield split as Rollins and Ambrose are probably going to get lost in the shuffle, and Roman Reigns is going to go to the top as he's their guy. At least as of right now, all three members of the Shield, despite their split,
they're strong.
All of them are top stars right now.
They're among the top guys in the company.
So you
This is going to sound very crazy to people. Are we going to start taking calls now? We're out of time. We got to get the hell out of here.
Take live phone calls. Take the rest. We'll.
I'll say this blanket statement. I'll just not even describe it. Right. Roman Reigns is not going to be the poster boy of that company.
I don't think so.
I don't think he's getting over as high as people think.
He doesn't have
Not yet. Yeah. Caller, you're on the air. What's going on? What's on your mind?
Yeah, there's something I wanted to talk about. You were talking about earlier about CM Punk possibly going to Ring of Honor.
Right.
I think there's a good possibility of that, because in August, Ring of Honor has the Death Before Dishonor show in Chicago, and then they're running the two huge buildings in for TV in September and October.
You know, I agree with you, man. I really do. I think that CM Punk, just the way that he left WWE, doesn't agree with the politics and doesn't agree with the current creative direction. I think there's a possibility. I mean, he's basically saying, right, we're going to get back into this, but I think that he would be the type of guy basically to not really a fuck you to WWE, basically to stick it to WWE.
What's the difference?
I guess there's no real difference, but basically, you know, I think the guy's good as far as money is concerned, and, you know, he's got money saved up, and I feel like the guy could go to a Ring of Honor and you know, take a pay cut, obviously, but work a couple of dates.
I don't even want to get into it again. I disagree.
We won't get into it.
But okay.
I agree with the caller. Caller, you're live on WZR TV. What's going on?
LA.
Yeah, it's me. Hey, just two quick questions. The first one is, if Cena was to tie or break Ric Flair's record with 15 belts, how would you guys feel? And the second one is, since I read that Vince McMahon wants to cut more talent, who do you see him cutting besides who he's already cut?
I heard the second one.
You know, if there was a second, I mean, he's
second
talking
one,
about
who else would be cut? What was the first?
He's talking about John Cena being a 15-time WWE.
Oh, that's a good one. Thank you, Kelly.
It
makes me sick that he might pass Ric Flair.
I know.
It makes me sick to my
stomach.
And
it's still early in his career. Not early in his career, but he's
it's inevitable that he's going to pass it. And that makes me sick. Now, Ric Flair's number shouldn't be 16, depending on what you count.
Right.
It should be around 20, 21.
Yeah.
But he might even still get that.
I know.
Either way, as far as who else gets released.
You know what? I was thinking about it earlier today, to be honest with you. If they were to do a second round of roster cuts, I would say, you know, they cut basically the dead weight last week.
I could see Heath Slater.
But I could see, you know, yeah, exactly. A guy like Heath Slater. And then if you want some bigger names that I think could go, Santino Marella came out and cut a promo the other day saying that his wrestling career may be winding down. Zack Ryder came out on Twitter and said the WWE shop is no longer selling,
might be gone organically.
Selling his merchandise. So people like that, I think you may see some bigger names if they are to do a second round of cuts. I think like Zack Ryder, Santino Marella, people
Del Rio's
like that.
Talked about retirement.
Del Rio's talked about retirement. I mean, some guys like that where they could save even
Swagger
more money. I don't think Swagger.
I could even see Swagger.
They could, you know, guys.
After this
Rusev
program.
I mean, listen, guys like Santino Marella and Zack Ryder are being paid more than guys like, you know, Curt Hawkins.
Los Matadors.
People
there's a
like
lot
that.
Of guys, yeah.
There are some guys, you know, some names that may surprise you. If they are to do a second round
Sandow,
of main cuts, I think you're going to see a lot of main roster or NXT roster cuts. A lot of the guys down in NXT.
They seem to be cutting the guys that actually get paid.
You're right. But I think in addition to that, you may see some NXT roster cuts in the near future. We'll see what happens. Tomorrow, if they were going to do it, well, tomorrow's July 4th. So everybody's out of the office tomorrow. So we'll see what happens. But caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's going on?
Hey, just got one quick question for you. What do you guys think about the character McMandow?
McMandow was the tits, bro. I thought. Thanks for the call. Yeah, I thought Damian Sandow's portrayal of Vince McMahon was great. You're fired was no Ryan Clark's You're Fired.
It wasn't, right?
Let me hear that.
You're fired.
You don't have to do it right there like that. It's kind of ear blast.
Sorry.
I think Callie's back, but okay. No, this is different.
Caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's up?
Hey, guys. I got three quick things, and I'll run them down real fast.
Sure.
First, the Vicky Guerrero thing. I can't believe her family's, like, other members of the Guerreros are dragging all this petty bullshit about how she
That's
got used into it. I mean, she took the best career opportunity she was ever going to get at the time. I mean, her husband just died. She got two kids to support by herself.
I agree.
I think it's the best thing she could have done, and especially with the way she handled all the shit they threw at her, like a class act.
Agreed.
I don't see anything they have to complain about.
I agree 100%. Both of us agree 100%.
Yeah, there's no arguments here. What else was on your mind?
Number two, if CM Punk's going to come back, I don't think it'll be after he's 40. I mean, I think we'll see it at least within the next 2-3 years, but I'm pretty sure it'll be definitely WWE.
Exactly.
And, I mean, I kind of feel like he's going to care more about the long-term payday if he's coming back 2 years from now, 3 years from now. He's not going to care so much about, I want to have a fun match. He's going to think, I want to do one or two more matches, get a big payday, and then be done with it.
All right, Boone agrees with you on that one, man. I mean, you know how I feel, and Boone agrees with you 100% on that. But I would say I think he's so pissed off at WWE, and we'll see what happens, man. We'll see.
And the last thing,
I had was the whole thing with Damian Sandow. And Chris Brown in the chat kind of confirmed this earlier, but I had heard that he had been doing the charity thing beforehand, giving out money, not doing it for publicity, and that word of that got back to Vince McMahon, and that Vince kind of feels there's a certain way to do things and you get publicity for it to make the company look better. So Sandow's been kind of getting the shitball treatment ever since then because of that.
Well, I know during WrestleMania weekend he was out giving money to homeless people, and I guess he didn't want that leaked out online, and it did wind up leaking out online. I don't know if he's the one that leaked it, but it did wind up, you know, coming online. But that was something that he said that he wanted to keep under wraps, but I'm not sure exactly what happened there. Caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's up?
How's it going, guys?
It's going good. How are you?
Not too bad. Hey, call from Vermont, long time listener. I emailed you a couple weeks back. Glad you're back on the radio.
Sweet.
I was at Money in the Bank last Sunday in Boston, and it was a real good show, but two things I want to add from it. I don't know how they showed it on the pay-per-view on TV, but the Randy Orton thing in the main event was the biggest pussy move I've ever seen. And I'm not saying it's his fault. But for WWE to pull him out of the ring for like 3 minutes was hilarious. For the crowd. People all around me were talking about it too. Like, it was nuts. And I don't know why they keep going to these Diva matches right before the main event. Like, you could feel all the energy go out of the Garden. It was a great crowd up until that. Like, the main event was buzzkilled because of that.
You know what it is? Here's two things, man. With the Divas matches, the reason they put them in there, they're basically filler matches where...
A bridge match, right.
Where they kind of calm the crowd down, where the crowd goes dead, and then... You know, they try to get them fired back up for the main event. So they put in a match, a Divas match, or a, you know...
Sit the crowd back down before standing
them up. Exactly. Yeah. Sit the crowd back down before standing them back up for the main event, which is kind of why they throw those Divas matches in. And then as far as Randy Orton, the bleeding is concerned...
What was he talking about?
That's a policy in WWE where anybody...
It was the bleeding? He said he wasn't sure why they had him... taking out of the
match.
It was the cut.
I know, I get that. Yeah, that's a product. I'm not WWE company guy, but you know, it's just funny the way it was in person. And
no,
you
know,
I've been to the last six pay-per-views at the Garden, and like the way that they've done it, it's been like that for the last bunch of main events. I don't know if it's because of Cena or what now, but it's like they get to the main event. And it's buzzkill because the matches they run before. But nice question, guys. Thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you. Yeah, we talked about that a lot earlier, where they ask the guys to be more aggressive.
Right.
And that results in, you're going to have more instances where a guy gets busted open hard way or an eye poke or an injury or whatever the fuck. And that was just a case where, Orton got cut. And
the problem is,
which makes no sense to me because pay-per-view A... if you're not watching it on the network, and does those policies fall into the network standards?
Well,
you don't have commercial sponsors that says, we're pulling out if we see blood.
Right. But the problem is, whenever it's blood getting on a fan in the crowd, right? If blood gets on a fan, fan can sue, or they could have HIV or whatever.
Is that what it is?
You know what I mean?
A liability thing with the live audience?
They don't want blood getting on any members of the crowd, and it could splatter this, that, and the other thing. So anytime somebody gets cut... WWE's policy is immediately
time out,
you gotta clean it off. And that's what happened with Randy Orton.
Okay, because like he said, it seemed like Orton disappeared all of a sudden.
That's good
because there's still five other guys, or what? Well, there was eight guys in that match. There was still seven other guys.
Well, in a match like that, but if it was a one-on-one,
and they've done it in the past, I think even brought up an example with him and Cena, I seem to recall that, where like in the middle of a one-on-one match, you gotta stop, clean the guy off. It's kind of weird.
Yeah, it is. To stop a match like that.
As far as how pro wrestling fans are conditioned. In an MMA fight, it makes sense to stop in the middle of the action, check the cut, alright, fight.
Right.
In a wrestling match, you don't stop for anything. Triple H pulls his quads, you put me in the walls, Jericho on the table.
Exactly.
It's kind of an adjustment phase for fans that grew up like we did, that, like, wait, what, you're stopping the match
because
he's bleeding?
Who cares? Because of bleeding? Yeah.
Yeah, so it's something that young fans that have grown up with this era, they're used to. People like us, we're still like, wait, what?
I want
to
talk about two more things before we get out of here, man. Number one is the TNA New York City TV tapings. They're going to be back at the Hammerstein Ballroom, or the Manhattan Center. They're going to be at the Grand Ballroom, but they're going to come back. They've already taped TV. They're going to be back in August for more TNA Impact tapings at the Grand Ballroom in the Manhattan Center. This last set of TNA Impact tapings in New York City, a lot of people are saying that they hit the reset button on TNA. So everything that you've pretty much seen on Impact, all the reports that we've gotten have been extremely positive. These shows are some of the best shows that the company has.
You said they're going back in August?
Put on. Back in August.
New York City?
Right.
To tape again, or they're airing August shows from New York City?
To tape Impact.
Okay, well, both, because the shit airing in August will be from the New York City taping.
Correct.
But
they're going right into...
If they're going back, from what we hear, not just one, and like their first New York City taping was awesome, the rest sucked.
Right.
From what I hear, all the New York City taping stuff was great. How long do they run that New York City market to where it's the same old shit? Because it really seems like if they really try, they're able to put on a great show.
The building...
They know... like, oh, Hardy Boys, you know.
The building is extremely expensive to rent out, but they went in...
the Hammerstein Ballroom.
The Manhattan Center, they've got the Hammerstein Ballrooms downstairs, the Grand Ballrooms upstairs on the 7th floor. Mm-hmm. TNA ran the 7th floor in the Grand Ballroom. About 1,200 fans can fit in there.
Okay.
But
what is our ROH fun when they go?
They sell them out. They sell out the Grand Ballroom and then downstairs in the Hammerstein.
But are ROH going to afford to rent that building if it's that expensive?
They only do 2 shows there a year, 3 shows there a year.
I didn't know it was that expensive to rent it. Very expensive. Like a low-rent building.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars to rent that building. But but
it's
anyways,
in the heart of Times Square, right? Like right across from...
Right across from Madison Square Garden.
Not in Times Square.
But it's right next to Times Square.
Is it?
Maybe...
Okay, I've never been.
Less than 10 blocks away from Times Square. I mean,
we were supposed to go, but you backed out like a punk son bitch.
It is Midtown Manhattan, but these...
Are we going the next time they come?
Yes. These TNA Impact tapings in New York City were said to have been the best shows, possibly...
Should have been there.
Some of the best shows that TNA has ever put on in the history of the company. So, they're going to start airing next week. They had taped TV in Pennsylvania the past two weeks. That's what you guys viewed tonight. They were in, I want to say, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Harrisburg or Harrington? Pennsylvania, but either way,
Pennsylvania, I believe. They start
next week, New York City, and the next, I think, 4 weeks of Impact tapings are going to be in New York City. I'm telling you, they basically hit the reset button. People are saying these are the best shows, some of the best shows that TNA has ever put on.
That's what I heard.
Reset Creative, and I'm going to check them out for the next couple of weeks.
I'm interested to check out, what the fuck was the one I wanted? There was one I wanted to see for a specific
Dudley's
reason.
And Hardy's.
I want to see that now that you said that there was something specific that was like...
That's on the
One
Night Only pay-per-view, by the way.
There was something that was like, oh shit, I gotta see that. I forget.
The table spot, Dixie Carter. Going through a table.
Maybe something at Destination X. I don't know. There was something where I saw it, I'm like, oh, I gotta make sure to catch that.
Yeah.
And it was like something I really wanted to see. I forget what it was. But
there's a lot of good stuff on these television tapings coming up. And then the last thing I want to talk about before we get out of here is Emma. Yesterday, it happened
that was an
Monday.
Interesting one.
Basically, what happened is prior to Raw on Monday, Emma went to a Walmart and was caught stealing a $21.
Before you get into the specifics, we'll remember that your sister was just arrested.
Was arrested at Walmart.
For shoplifting at Walmart. Something my sister's been arrested for many times in the past.
Right.
Her boyfriend, Will. Many times in the past. Walmart's a target, I guess.
Walmart is a target? Is that a pun?
Well, they got everything.
Target?
Walmart, because of Walmart and Target.
Anyways, but...
That's only going to work in the United States.
Arrested.
Half our audience is English.
$21.
They got Target and...
$21.14 iPhone cover for your phone.
Yeah, and anything under $25 is a misdemeanor.
It's a misdemeanor. Basically, she got caught stealing. The cops came, and she was arrested.
Can I ask a
mugshot came. I'm trying to get out of here.
I know you are, but it's about this. When she stole that, didn't she pay for other items, and that just was one she did.
That's what she claims.
Okay, so she went, they would have security camera footage of her going through checkout.
You would think so.
So she bought something, but didn't pay for that. It wasn't like she just went in, stole that, and left.
We haven't seen the footage from Walmart.
Okay, but from what we hear, she bought other items, and that was just one she didn't pay
that's
for.
That's what she okay. and her lawyer claim, that she bought other items. So,
I think that's important to the story. But
So basically...
Bethlehem's where they were in Pennsylvania, I'm sorry.
Okay, Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Yeah. So anyways, it came out on Tuesday that she had been arrested. Yesterday, WWE.com put an article up that she had been fired from the company. Now, 2 hours later, they announced Emma has been reinstated upon further review of what happened.
Literally one line, like, upon further review of the situation, blah, 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 more fancy words, we have reinstated, what was her name, Tessa Woodward, whatever the fuck it is, Renee Young. Renee Young,
by the way.
I get those two confused.
Renee Young taking over WWE Superstars commentary
her and Tom
place
Phillips.
Of Josh Matthews.
Yeah, her and Tom Phillips. And she's going to do the post-shows, pre-shows, and the kickoff shows.
Congratulations to Renee Young. The first
she's so
ever,
good at her job.
The first ever women's commentator
she's
on,
really good,
on WWE Superstars.
I think she's really good.
Very good.
Like, really good.
She's done some work for NXT in the past.
Yes,
on commentary.
Yeah,
right. And has been really
she's
good.
She's done a lot of hosting work. And
a lot of knowledge.
lot of hosting work, a lot of panel work, social media lounge, you count that, and then now commentary, backstage interviewing. Like, she's really good at all of that stuff, too. Yeah, she's really good. And she seems, like we talked about it before, it's always hot when it's a hot chick, and it's always even hotter when a hot chick that really seems to dig it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like,
I think,
like,
I think Renee Young.
Remember how hot Trish Stratus was? Not only because she was clearly the hottest, but, like, she was so into it and so good at it. It's like, oh, it makes her even hotter. Like, she really, like, loves what we love, and she's hot.
I think Renee Young is one of the hottest divas on the roster, in my
opinion. She's up there.
She's up there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Emma, so they wind up firing her and then rehiring her.
In the same,
later.
In within hours.
Listen, I don't know what happened. I mean, listen.
Well, we know the story.
Well, did Emma not, here's my original thought.
Okay.
On Monday, Emma got arrested, and then she shows up backstage to Raw. Maybe she tried to hide it from WWE officials, thinking this will never come out.
I think she told them.
It's only a Walmart. Now, if she did tell them, and
I'm
they went...
I'm pretty sure she did. I'll tell you why.
Okay. All right, no doubt. So if she told them, and then they go, and they fire her, and then, you know, there was all this talk. You've had Jack Swagger,
who was arrested
for DUI. There was Cameron, who
that's,
was arrested
okay.
for DUI.
Let's
and then
Cameron.
Talk about Cameron. What did Cameron do?
Cameron not only was DUI, which is way worse than shoplifting.
Right.
But she not only did she offer to bribe an officer $10,000 to get out of the situation, which takes a DUI, which is you could kill somebody.
Right.
Shoplifting, you're not killing anybody.
Somebody.
So it's a more serious offense, and she tried to bribe the officer. But the part that matters is that Emma, like you said, either did or didn't tell the office. I think she did, because the arguments I've been hearing was that not only did Cameron have a DUI and try to bribe an officer, but she never told the company. They found out by reading it in the media, like TMZ and stuff. So that would lead me to believe that Emma did tell them, because they didn't find out through the media. They found out, I'm assuming, because she told them. Or that just somebody contacted, hey, Emma's just been arrested. They found out that way. Not like, oh, TMZ reports Emma's been arrested. What the fuck?
Right.
Like Cameron did.
Right.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens. But anyways, they wound up rehiring Emma, and she's back with WWE.
And I wrote a column about it, eWrestlingNews.com. The bottom line, which I state in the column, she gets to go back to doing her mid-card. Who gives a shit? So they could have fired her or rehired her.
Think she gets to do that anymore.
She's done it two or three times.
She's jobbed out.
Yeah.
Putting photos up on the Titantron of fat Emma photos from back in the day. Remember what they did to Caitlyn?
She's a nobody again.
Oh, my God, dude.
Or Mickey James, Piggy.
Oh, Piggy James, right? Yeah, but anyways, Emma's back in WWE. It was just weird the way they did it. They fired her and then said, well, upon further review...
We're not going to
fire her. It was really weird the way they did that. But, I mean, listen, let's give her the benefit of the doubt. We don't know. We weren't there. None of us were there. We don't know if she paid for other things, and maybe it was just a simple
mistake. That's what I heard, that she did pay for other things, which would make it you to believe, lend you to believe that maybe she, like, tried it on her phone or threw it in her purse or something, like, forgot about it.
Right.
Because she was also in a rush. This supposedly happened around noon or 1 p.m.
Right before Raw, right.
Well, noon or 1 p.m., and they're supposed to be in the building by 2. That's the rule in WWE or something.
So it was probably you arrive into Hartford, Connecticut.
She's in a rush.
Shopping, you do a little shopping at
here's
Walmart.
Here's the money for my Spree, my bubble gum.
Self-checkout lane.
Okay, all right, well...
Cops
scan, here's the money for my Spree. Scan, here's my bubble gum. All
right,
receive.
Right.
I leave. Oh, shit, I forgot. Yeah.
It was in the cops confirmed in the police report that she was in the self-checkout, which makes it even more possible that she was in the self-checkout lane and possibly forgot to scan something. So give her the benefit of the doubt. Nonetheless,
even if she didn't, she wasn't drunk driving and damn near killing people and then lying about it and bribing officers to get away with it.
Somebody on my Facebook page said stealing is a lot worse than a DUI.
Wow.
I told them, I said, that is the
dumbest. What was their rationale? Did they have an explanation?
That was it. And I said, that is the dumbest comment.
You didn't ask them
so wait a minute. So a DUI, ask them to explain, but they never replied.
Of course
or if
not.
They did, if they did, I didn't see it later down in
there's
the
There's no explanation for that.
But, so, stealing can kill somebody? Because
no.
I know a DUI,
yes.
If you're DUI, driving under the influence, you can kill somebody.
It's happened many times.
You can kill
Nick Hogan.
An innocent bystander, right? Whereas, if you're stealing something, you're not killing anybody.
Unless you're stealing
anything.
A gun to shoot somebody,
it
you know what I mean? Like,
ridiculous.
No. Hey. An iPad mini case. That's the name of my column, by the way. An iPad mini case versus drunken bribery is what I called it. eWrestlingNews.com.
You know what I call
check
this?
Check out eFightNews.com.
You know what
real
I call
quick,
this?
Before we get out, back up off me. eFightNews.com as well. What do you call what?
I call this a Thursday night WZRT.
A 2-hour broadcast.
More
2-hour and 30-minute broadcast. All right, well, we went late.
So we gave him a show this week.
We gave him a show.
I didn't have to take my hat off
no
next
hat.
Tuesday night, right? We gave him what they wanted.
Gave him what they wanted.
We went over 2 hours.
2 hours.
Tons of news.
Tons of news.
Ran down Money in the Bank.
That too.
Ran down Raw.
That too.
We out.
We out.
For Matt Boone.
Me.
Ryan Clark.
Him.
Saying see you next Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern Time, WZRonline.com. Happy 4th of July.
Oops.
Be safe this weekend. Niggas got it, but I'm bottom, now we here.